Gray Zone.
You are listening to The Gray Zone. I am Gray Thompson, and today I'm joined by my esteemed salubrious guest, Morgan Thomas, who I've been looking forward to having here for a long time. Welcome, Morgan.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
We are at the Growler House in the village of West Greenville, our sponsor this week, drinking delicious beer. What are you drinking again?
85-something.
Brewery 85. Marzen. It has a bigger name, but we don't care. That's all you need to know. It's an Oktoberfest beer. I'm drinking, I don't even know. It sounds like Uyagalele. That's literally what I was going to call it. It's got like one consonant in there, and I forget where it's from, but it's an IPA in a pretty glass. Thank you for having us here, Growler House. We love this place. Thank you, Craig. Thank you, Dylan. Thank you, Tyson. Thank you, everybody. Also brought to you by irongreenville.net. Go to the irongreenville.net app. It'll tell you everything you need to know about what's going on in and around Greenville. Everything that's not on FET Greenville TV will be on Ion Greenville. Also do your college football pick-ems on Ion Greenville. I did horrible last weekend, but I think everybody did. What a puke weekend for college football. We'll get to that in a minute. Also, FET Greenville. We come out every week. F-E-T-E. You know, we changed the name, sort of, and the branding from the FET College Football Podcast because FET is a word, it's a French word for festival that nobody knows, right? And so Gray doesn't exactly have, oh, Gray with two G's? No. Gray Zone, G-R-E-Y, is in FET Greenville Magazine, F-E-T-E. You'll figure it out. Comes out every Wednesday. Thank you for listening. Thank you for supporting our sponsors. Come to the Growler House, watch every single college football game, and drink mad beer like we're about to do. Okay. Where do you want to start, Morgan? Anywhere in particular?
I don't have anywhere in particular. Good. This is a beautiful area for sure. I love this this restaurant, this Growler House. I love it.
This used to, I say used to be, it's still kind of considered the arts district of West Greenville. We're literally sitting on my side that used to be my art studio. Again, we talked about this a little bit before, and now more people come here to see my art, the chalk art, than ever when I was here. The Anchorage right around the corner. Have you ever been there?
No, I haven't.
I'll keep this short. That's my favorite restaurant in town. I think it's okay to say it's the best. I think it's the best. The menu is exquisite. Even their plates are good. But listen, take your wife out there sometime and spend $50 per person, right? So $100 for the whole night. And you're looking at me like, what? I don't know. I don't eat that kind of food. Listen, it's special occasion food for sure. But it's called the chef's tasting menu, right? And so it's $50 per person and you don't have to think about it. They come to your table. They show you all the food. It's all fresh. They have their own farm and traveler's rest. You leave full. It's terrific. The Anchorage, I recommend it. I'm done. They're not a sponsor, but I had to get that out there.
Well, you know, I'm one of those people that gets stuck on one or two restaurants. So it's kind of, you know, anti-Greenville, right? Because there's so many restaurants available to choose from and to kind of test.
Did you ever have Guthrie's in Clemson?
No, I haven't.
All this, a few weeks ago, there was this debate about fried chicken between Chick-fil-A and, what was it, Bojangles and Popeyes. It doesn't matter. I don't care. It's all... Who cares when it's fried chicken? It's all good. Like, you can't claim to be the best. They can't play each other. It's not like we have a playoff for this crap. But Guthrie's, God, it was $5 a plate, Morgan. So if you went to Guthrie's and you were picking up food for six of your blasted out friends who were too hungover to talk, all they need to do is give you $5. That's after tax. So each meal is $5. The fried chicken was so good. I don't know what happened, but it's not there. The reason why I asked is I was hoping you were going to tell me what happened. Like, yeah, they were smuggling endangered animals or something. I don't know. But I miss Guthrie's. Did you live in Clemson? Can we start with you? How about we start with you?
First of all, fine.
I'm super fascinated you're here. I'm going to let you talk in a second. Morgan does a great video show. I'm going to let you talk about it in a minute. I don't remember how I found about it. I imagine it was through Ellis Tolbert and 4th and 16.
Probably.
Right? And when I saw you doing your videos, I thought you had been doing this for years. And I felt like, finally, thank God I found this guy who can do a little bit of a deep dive in a professional-looking environment with people who know about Clemson and can talk about Clemson so I can get this stuff in a way that I like to. Because a lot of the radio stuff, I don't.
Right.
And they don't give you good information all the time. It's usually just the hot takes and debates and callers and stuff like that. So first of all, thank you. You do a great job with your video stuff on YouTube. I love it.
Well, I appreciate it.
Tell me more about how you got started with it and how long you've been doing that.
Well, to answer your original question, I'm originally from Anderson. And so born and raised in Anderson, South Carolina. So not too far away. Even went to
next door.
Even went to undergrad at Anderson University. So okay. Go Trojans! You know, they just announced that they are going to have their own football team in the next couple of years. I think 2023 or 2026. I can't remember exact date.
Is that why you're not wearing any Clemson gear today, buddy? Huh?
No, I'm not wearing any Clemson gear because it's all in the wash. I should have 10 pairs so I can wear one every day of the week, right? And rotate every 2 weeks, right? But no, you know, sometimes I like to change it up. You know, I like to go incognito.
I got my orange and white Quest hat because I've gotten grief before for wearing the same school shirt and hat before, mm-hmm. like Alabama or let's just say Clemson shirt and Clemson hat. Like, mm-hmm. Dude, nobody, you're not a coach. Don't be like that. All right. So I got Quest up here in the same colors as my shirt. I'm looking good. Nobody knows that you even care about college football.
Yeah, right now, no. I got, like, you know, this Izod. I'm a big Izod brand
snob. Yeah, you look like a Notre Dame fan.
Yeah, green and blue right now. Yeah, I'm not really representing as well as I could be. So I'm going to go change. Let's go back. Let's go to break real quick.
It's fine.
And let me change.
And we're back.
But, yeah, so like I said, I was born in Anderson. Actually, you know, served in the military right after high school. Went to Westside High School, served in the military, and you know, went to Anderson University for business. Not really like a creative, I think everybody's creative, but I wasn't really like into the broadcast. I didn't go for broadcast or communication right out the bat.
What
I went
did
for
you
business.
Go for, by the way?
Business management,
okay.
You know, at Anderson University, and I loved it there. I think it was great for me because of the small school environment and being able to have those professors really invest in you and not feel like one in a number, right? But I always had the dream of eventually going to Clemson. And so now I work in marketing over at Verizon Wireless, the corporate office in Greenville. And I do employee engagement, employee communication, graphics, and video.
Okay.
And I kind of fell into it. I was working my way up from the bottom out after the military and after college, kind of worked my way up to, you know, Verizon, and then kind of had to start at the bottom. I had to take phone calls and, you know, customer service 101, right? The 800 number. Then kind of became a supervisor, and then some doors opened to where I was asked to make some t-shirts, of all things. And so I made a couple of t-shirts for some of the departments, and they liked them. And so I started making banners, and then they said, can you do video? And I said, okay, yeah, I can do video. And I kept kind of...
Which, by the way, you couldn't, right?
No, I couldn't. I couldn't. I was just making it up, you know. But at the same time, I was going to Clemson for my MBA. So I actually...
Gotcha.
It was a long-time dream of mine to go to Clemson.
And so you were at Clemson proper to do the MBA? This was before they built the MBA downtown Greenville?
No, it was downtown at the one building, right?
Okay.
And so it's a beautiful, man, beautiful little building. They have like a couple of different levels there, right? Or different floors that they cover, like four or five floors there that they mm-hmm. own or they rent out, right? And so it's a lot of great views of, you know, the mountains and the city and everything.
You've got to appreciate, and I hate to interrupt again, but the Clemson MBA building, you can go up in, I think it's the sixth floor you look down on for free, and you look down on, you know, I'm not going to say the name of the rooftop bar across the street because I don't want to get anybody in trouble, because you have to pay to go up there on some nights.
Right.
And you don't have to pay to go up to look down on those people from Clemson. Go Tigers. I love the NBA. I love that they're down in the one building. So you had a good experience there, huh?
Yeah, I loved it. I mean, it was a lot of grinding. I mean, I was working second shift at the time, and then, you know, trying to take some, I had to like change my schedule around to go at night because it's only night classes, you know, after six, like, executive classes, you know, for after 5 o'clock people. Well, I wasn't a 5 o'clock guy. I was kind of working my way up into a better schedule. And then, the really cool thing, the unintended benefit was that I got access to Adobe Cloud as a student. And so I started learning it on my own, just, you know, on YouTube, and then learning Adobe tutorials and things like that and practicing on the weekends.
All and of it, Photoshop,
yeah, everything.
Lightroom,
I started in Photoshop and worked to Illustrator, and then worked to Premiere. And so then, because I knew at work people were kind of interested in me doing it, you know, not on an exclusive basis, but just here and there. And so I wanted to learn for my own, you know, benefit too. But I really liked the creative stuff, and then that just snowballed into I landed a position on a national level. Now my boss is in New York City, and so I do graphics and video for Verizon for internal, not advertisements like you'd see on commercials, but internal stuff that employees get to benefit from. And I get to travel the country now, you know, getting to interview different employees and get their experience and interview vice presidents and, you know, kind of just be that encouraging voice for employees. Because, you know, sometimes at work can be not very encouraging. And so it's I'm glad that Verizon invests in things like that, because not every company has that that ability monetarily or even wanting to do that. And so I'm glad that Verizon does that. And so back in December, my boss came to me and said, hey, one of our main talent, in on-camera talent, is out sick and going to be out for like a month, and we need you to step in. And they said, you've been a sales manager, right? You can do it. And I said, well, I mean, I guess I can do it. I've never been in front of a camera with lights.
Say,
and
first of all, that has nothing to do with sales. He could tell that you were not afraid to say yes.
Right.
You were not afraid to take chances and take risks.
I'm definitely somebody that says yes, sometimes to my detriment, but you know, you can't, sometimes you have to say no because of your
it's important to learn to say no.
Right.
Yeah. But I think he could tell that you're not afraid of a challenge.
No,
that's
no.
The difference. It had nothing to do with sales.
You know, and I think some of it comes with that military, you know, just taught me to just have confidence in myself and you know, I like to try new things. Even if I fail, I'd rather fail and know that I tried. And so he said, hey, we've got somebody out sick. I need you to fill in for them and go home and practice in front of a mirror. It'll be fine. And, you know, I'm really nervous at this point. I'm like, oh, my goodness. I've only been a video editor or a video shooter or you know, a videographer, I guess you could say. But, you know, so as you can tell, I don't know all the terminology and what things mean. I'm just kind of like, you know, faking it till you make it, right? Just trying to figure it out and take a hobby and turn it into a job, right? And so I go home and I said, man, I got in front of the mirror and I said, this is not working for me. This is, and I have done presentations before in front of hundreds of people at Verizon and
that's almost easier, isn't it?
I feel
into a camera lens?
It's weird. It really is. You would think hundreds of people staring at you. Now, I do get nervous for that, for sure. But my coach used to always tell me at Westside is when I played soccer there was that the nervousness is just because you care. It's not because you know, use it as a way of confidence, like you care about it instead of a way of, oh man, I'm not adequate. You know, so think of it that way.
I love that.
And so I always thought of, okay, I'm really nervous right now, but it's because I really care about this and I want it. It's important to me. It's not because I'm not adequate, right?
Right.
So,
afraid.
Yeah, or I'm afraid, right? Because that you start going down that path, you can't come back from that.
I love this.
And so,
keep going.
And so, so I got in front of the mirror, and I thought it was just really weird. I've always been a type of person that talks in the car or talks in front of a mirror or in the shower, right? But it was just weird for me. And so I said, you know what? The only way I'm really going to know is if I get in front of the camera. And the only way I can do that, well, I looked around the house. And I said, well, I have a camera on my computer. What's something that I can talk about? I can't talk about Verizon stuff. Let me talk about Clemson stuff.
Yep.
So I said, well, let me go on Facebook Live. And my wife was like, you got to be kidding me. You're not going to do this right now. The Facebook Live, like nobody does this. Well, she actually went on a dinner date with some girlfriends. But
so she didn't watch.
She didn't know it. No. She didn't know at the time. She watches every night now. But at the first show, I don't think she was there watching. But I had about five people watching. I talked about Clemson versus Notre Dame in the playoffs last year, right around, you know, December time frame. And I had about five people watching. I had a few text messages afterwards saying, we loved it. You need to do it again. And I said, oh, you know, I don't know. We'll see if I have time. Well, you know, the national championship came up. And I said, you know, I really feel like I have a lot of thoughts about this game.
Yeah, you do.
A lot of people were saying Clemson had no chance. And I was like, you know what? Clemson really matches up really well. If you think about it, if you look at this player versus this player or this player versus this, I'm like, Clemson
matches
up. You're
speaking my language. Nobody talked like that last
week. Nobody talked about
that.
Nobody.
And anybody I tried to talk about that with was, they got mad at me.
Well, I say nobody, but I will tell you this, that I did.
You did?
So
Deptula said something about it.
I was like, I am going to get on.
Deptula gave Clemson a chance.
Right. And so there's not very many people, and I love Walt, and, you know, I think, you know, he likes to be right about a lot of things, and he is, for sure.
I was going to say, often he is.
And I love listening to him. People call back in and say, I'm sorry, you were right, I was wrong. Because he is very often right. But
I'm not that guy. I have to call every week.
I got on, and, you know, I had about 20 people watching the second time around. And everybody was like, yeah, this is great. Keep doing it. And then they won the national championship. And I said, okay, well, this is going to be huge if I do it. Well, I had about 60 people watching live. And this was just on my personal page.
Sure.
And I said, well, you know, if my friends like it, maybe this is something, right? So I had a guy call me from Black's Tire, who's a kind of a family friend, and he said, hey, if you go public with this, I'll be your sponsor. And I said, well, let's do it, I'm like, let's try it, right? I don't know what this means, but let's try it. So I made made a public page.
Good.
Made a logo, made kind of an intro video of my own, and asked my friend at the time, Alan Adams, who's my co-host now, but I asked him, he said, no, I'm too busy, I can't do it. You know, I'll have to look at my schedule maybe sometime after basketball season, maybe in April or so.
Okay.
So I kept doing it, and it kept getting more and more popular, getting that a couple of thousand views every show I did.
Sure.
And I'm like, man, this is now I'm addicted. And so then around March timeframe, Alan joined in, and it jumped even better, because I feel like, you know, we talked about this earlier, mm-hmm. when you're in front of the camera by yourself, man, it is very weird, right? Because you're just talking and talking.
It's always weird.
For a long time, for an hour, I had by myself. And I didn't have phone calls at the time. I just hopefully had people in the chat. And then when Alan got on, I had somebody to bounce back and forth off of and also help me with the workload. So yep. I didn't have to think of an hour's worth of content. And so we just kind of, it skyrocketed from there. We did a couple of videos on some recruiting things because this is kind of around spring practice time. We did spring practice stuff. And then it was kind of towards March Madness. You know, Clemson wasn't doing that well, but we had a lot to talk about for sure. A lot of controversy or you know, debate over how good Clemson's coach is, right, Brad Brownell.
Right.
But we just kept going with it, and it just kept taking off. And then I slowly got sponsors here and there, and then I met a guy. A guy started liking my stuff named Mark Childress. And
I've heard of him.
You've heard of him? He's
on. Of course I have. Sorry, I say of course. Yeah, Mark Childress, local news guy, or mm-hmm. a local sports anchor, I should say, right?
So he fills in for
Dedicated
Pete Yannity.
Clemson fan.
Mm-hmm, big Clemson fan. Went to Furman, mm-hmm. and he's filled in on News Channel 7. And
I didn't know he went to Furman.
I believe so, yeah. Yeah, he went to Furman. And then
you all the time.
and then he he had it on his own Facebook show. And he was like, man, I like what you're doing. It's really well put together. Well, I was just using my graphics and my knowledge from work and putting it together. And I my goal was to make an ESPN quality show with graphics and everything, but also have less of an SEC bias, you know, have more of a Clemson feel. So I focus on what I know, which is Clemson. I don't know every single team. I'm not like Kirk Herbstreit, who knows everybody.
You're not supposed to.
But there are people who do, which I admire a lot.
There is. I think a lot of people are sort of preconditioned to think that they're supposed to. This is the 21st century. There's people out there who only want to hear from people who dressed up like My Little Pony, right? And that's a small market, but I tell you what, they probably spend some money, and it's niche, right?
Right.
You find it.
Right.
Clemson is a big market that more people want to listen mm-hmm. to, that it's expanding more than ever.
Right.
I'm surprised to hear you say all this, that you've only been doing this for that long. This is literally your first full season.
Yeah, we didn't know how it was going to be coming into the season.
And I hate to interrupt again, mm-hmm. but I say that because you don't act like it. You.
I appreciate
your show. It's Alan, right?
Yeah, Alan is my co-host.
It looks like you've been doing this for at least a couple of years. Not that this is your first season. You don't look nervous. It doesn't feel scripted. It mm-hmm. feels natural, and it feels great. And this is one of my big things. Look, you just said you've got a kid, you've got a wife, you've got a job, you've got a career, you've got mm-hmm. all these things. You even have to travel.
Mm-hmm.
And here you are with your own voice doing it from nothing, including your career that didn't exactly come from trying to pursue exactly what you're doing right now.
Right.
You just got to go out there and do it. And the opportunities exist more now than ever here in the 21st century. Mm-hmm. I'm blown away. I was excited to have you here. I still am. I say was.
I appreciate that.
This is kind of a sincere surprise. And this is kind of what I was exactly what I was hoping to get from meeting new people for the podcast. So thank you again.
Yeah.
Great job. Keep going.
Yeah,
go on.
I guess it's easy to talk about yourself, right?
No, it's not, by the way. You're even doing a good job with that. So, for example, okay, it looks like you're in a studio. What studio is that when you do your video? Because it looks
it's
great.
All smoke and mirrors, man. It's
I know
all
what it
smoke
is. I know what it
you
is.
Know what it is.
I work on that side of the camera,
yeah,
too.
It's green screen.
So it's literal green screen because,
yeah,
Alan,
yeah.
That must mean that he has a green cap.
Yes, it is. Unfortunately, there's
unfortunately.
A lot of...
I have no problem with that. I love looking through Alan's cap. Like
and
it's
seeing
a fourth
into
dimension.
Nowhere.
Oh, yeah.
You're one of the few probably that picked that up, but I picked that up for sure.
I can't not see it, but it doesn't bother me. I enjoy it.
We have little hiccups here and there, and that's what's the fun part about it. It's live. You can't go back. And so
I don't do live.
Something happens.
I've done it before. I don't do live.
This podcast, if I flub up here in a minute, you can delete it. But for me, I can't delete it. And I'll say some goofy things, and I'm like, man, why did I say that? But it's live, so I have to just keep going with it.
Well, I've said some goofy things. I don't delete stuff. I literally said last week that Ohio State's running back was Swift.
Oh, no.
It's not. I mean, it's a good descriptive term.
I mean, yeah, he could be Swift, right? Talking about his agility or,
didn't know until I heard from about a dozen Ohio State fans.
Oh,
like,
man.
Don't you know he's Georgia? I'm like, yeah, of course I do. Why would you say that?
Yeah,
oh,
right.
You said it on your podcast.
You better know your stuff when it comes to sports, for sure. And I know my role too. I am the host. I'm a producer, and I let Alan kind of be the analyst, the guy who deep dives into stuff. Now I deep dive into stuff too. I'm gonna give myself credit too. But
I'm gonna give you credit right here for everything you did this week from the UNC game with your little finger drawn arrows and stuff
on
for
Twitter,
the routes and the defensive positioning.
Right.
That is the stuff that I love to do.
Right.
That number one, I don't have the time to do. Number two, I don't want to do. I love the deep dive stuff. I'd never seen you do that before. You did a great job
first
with
time.
That, and I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, and I had a little bit of extra time, free time over the weekend to kind of go through. And go through and kind of look back at every offensive play and see what went wrong, and I'm sure we'll get into that a little bit further.
Well,
but
to be fair, that's the one everybody wanted to know what went wrong, because it was a close game, 21-22.
There was a lot of glaring things.
21-20.
It was 21-20. I think a lot of glaring things, and I think a lot of fixable things, not panic button for sure. There are some bigger concerns, I think, than everything's not a concern for sure. There are things that they did really well, and there are things that they could definitely improve on, but we'll talk about that as we go. But
let's talk about it right now. As far as I'm concerned, it's Trevor. He just needs to stop sailing a few more balls.
Man.
He can still sail 6, 7, 8 balls a game as long as one or two less of them aren't sailed.
Mm-hmm.
Clemson wins by another touchdown or two.
Well, if you know, as I showed on my Twitter account at Clemson Morgan, if you see some of the plays that were called, I think it's half and half. Trevor and Tony Elliott and Jeff Scott kind of getting a little bit, I wouldn't say lazy, but it's a little bit too repetitive on the play calling. When it was 3rd and 6, they would go deep and they would send four wide receivers deep. And
I noticed
with their intention of, okay, if you're going to play cover two man and just basically cover everybody, we're just going to try to find the one-on-one and let our receiver do his thing. Well, obviously T. Higgins was successful in that. Justin Ross was successful certain times, but it wasn't consistently successful. Mm-hmm. And it to the point where the game was really close, and it didn't really need to be because of certain plays where, why are you 3rd and 9, 3rd and 11, 3rd and 6 and calling all streaks down the field? Obviously Trevor Lawrence looked at the guys that were covered, double covered, and he said, no, I'm not going to throw there. Thankfully, he did throw to the guys that were, I think if the throw was better, could have won a couple. There were one to Ladson and one to Ross in the end zone that if he didn't overthrow them, they probably would have been caught or at least jump ball situation 50-50.
Which I'm all about.
So you can kind of blame. I mean, you can kind of put the blame or the responsibility on Trevor a little bit. But then there were times where in that 3rd and 6 where they actually went for it on the very next play, Travis Etienne was just sitting there all by himself with, 3rd and 6. All he needed was just to throw it down.
Yep.
And as far as the play calling, too, when you look at other plays, they really wouldn't do – quick developing plays. So they would, instead of doing slants, which they only did one slant all game, which was unsuccessful. But just because it's unsuccessful the one time you try it doesn't mean it couldn't have been successful more. Appalachian State did really well with that.
Mm-hmm.
But so what they would do is they would run like 10 and in. Well, if you got guys blitzing on the weak side, where there's not enough coverage.
Yeah, often.
And I'll tell you, you got to give credit to the Tar Heels, because it's almost like they Brent Venables Clemson.
They did.
They pulled a Brent on.
Who's their defensive Clemson coordinator?
I can't
forgot his name too, and it doesn't matter.
Let's Google it.
I should know it because he's so good.
Pause and let's Google it. But no, I'm just kidding. But
it's not that important.
But yeah, they would. I think they
he did his job.
A lot of people said, well, they didn't. they didn't run across the middle. They did, if you really look at it, it just, they were very slow developing. And I don't mean slow because they were running slow. They were running fast. It's just they had to go 10 yards and then go in. And by the time the guy gets to 10 yards, you got a guy blitzing in with nobody covering him. And a little bit responsibility goes to Travis Etienne because he was late on a couple. Man, the one that he did good that ended up being a big play, he got annihilated. And so Travis was getting beat up in the pass protection game.
I think he's done a good job of blocking. Nobody really seems to talk about because he hasn't been flawless at it, I guess. I don't know.
Well, I think he gets a lot of grief about it for sure because he was late a couple against UNC, but he wasn't terrible by any means. And, I mean, he really needs to be that workhorse running back. He doesn't need to be the blocking guy.
Yeah.
You know,
I have a hard time putting more blame on Travis Etienne than I do putting the ball in his damn hands. That's all I want to see. That's all anybody wants to see.
Right, and they ran the ball a lot, but Trevor really had the most success, so they kept giving him the ball. They actually split. I think it was like 15-15, Travis and Trevor. But Travis couldn't get anything going to the right side. If you look at majority of the plays to the right side between Cervinka and Akram, nowhere to be found. I mean, he couldn't get in between Pollard and Cervinka. The A gap, the B gap, the outside off tackle, nothing on the right-hand side worked at all, it seemed like. Left-hand side, though, I did a chart. I hadn't posted it yet. But if you look on the left-hand side... the chart's just like through the roof on left-hand side as far as running goes. So Travis was very successful. And, you know, John Simpson came out the night after, I think it was the same night or the next night, he came out and said, hey, if they would have just ran the ball more to my side or ran the ball more, we would have been more successful. And I agree. If they would have ran the ball more to John Simpson's side, you know, I think it would have been more successful. But it's kind of hard to be one-dimensional only running to one side.
Yeah.
I think Clemson's got to figure out a way to fix that. Because, you know, if you notice, Trevor doesn't even roll out to the right side much at all. And I think there's something to that. I think there needs to be some addressing of the right-hand offensive line. Maybe. The Sean Pollard was kind of shared guard, or he was a better guard, I think, than a center. And now he's playing center.
Okay.
And Cervinka, some people say they should switch. And Cervinka should be the center. And Pollard should be the guard, and maybe try that.
I tell you, that's a maybe tough some people spot say, to switch. That's
yeah, it
a
is.
Tough spot. I think people take for granted how hard it is to switch any positional group on either side of the line.
Well, at least
left
staying...
guard and right guard, it's the same thing.
No.
It's
oh,
a totally different. I wish they just use different names, you know, like we do for free safety and safety. Like, what's the difference, Gray? Like,
right.
The difference is whether or not you can cover that 16 extra yards.
Mm-hmm.
You can't. Most
yeah.
players can't.
And typically the guys on the right side should be more of your running guys because everybody's usually right-handed, so it kind of helps
exactly.
the quarterback to run to the right side and the running back to run to the right side. And so the fact that the right side has been the struggle is kind of a little bit of a concern for me. But the bye week came in a good spot for them to adjust and look back and make and kind of self-scout themselves, you know.
The best possible spot, right? After a close win on mm-hmm. the road to stay undefeated, right?
Yeah.
They played two out-of-conference opponents, if I remember right.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
The 49ers, and which is Charlotte, and then Texas A&M.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody else has been ACC.
So Power 5, one team that wasn't Power 5. Other than that, all Power 5.
Which I think is not many teams have played that many Power 5 teams. I think there's a stat out there that says Clemson's played the most or tied with the most.
It's weird. Yeah, you mentioned that. Like Alabama, LSU, mm-hmm. they're both undefeated, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like Florida.
Mm-hmm.
Except Florida has an extra win.
Mm-hmm.
Like, what?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, that's right, because they played in, like, middle of August or something, right? You know, like it's Miami.
Right.
We'll get to it in a minute, too.
Yeah.
But anyway, to dovetail from that into... So they come off of a close road win against North Carolina for a bye week and then hosting perennial rival Florida State.
Oh, yeah.
Could there be a more perfect bloodbath, Morgan? And I'm okay calling it a bloodbath. I think
Ooh.
Florida State's starting to do better,
mm-hmm.
but now you just pissed off Clemson. A Clemson who isn't playing their ceiling, they're mm-hmm. not playing their elite level best, and
no,
now
not.
Everybody's been talking about them for 2 weeks
mm-hmm.
about how bad they are and what this means, and dropping them out of number one in every single poll. They're not ranked number one in any poll now, right?
No, they're not. And I think that plays right into Dabo Sweeney's hands. You know, being the underdog is what he
Dabo
wants.
Dabo Sweeney doesn't have to do anything. Are you kidding me? I love Dabo. And he's a good coach. And he's going to coach. I'm not mm-hmm. saying he's just going to, like, not do anything. What I'm saying is these guys are self-motivated. He's mm-hmm. taught these guys consistently for a decade how to self-motivate.
Mm-hmm.
They don't need his help right now. All he's got to do is show up. They're going to do it on the road. I think Florida State's getting better, but I don't expect this to be anything but a blowout.
Well, I think that, you know, I agree and I disagree in the sense that...
Let me have it.
You know, it you know, there's only, like, I think, 11 seniors. So those there's a lot of young guys out there. I think it's 80 freshmen and sophomores. So you're looking at a lot of young guys who... we have yet to see how they can handle that adversity, right? I think Trevor Lawrence said the same thing. It's good to have adversity now.
You had it.
Because
did you not just have it at Chapel Hill?
Yeah, yeah.
That's got to count.
It's good to have it
now.
Yeah, it's good to have that adversity now against a Tar Heel team that really gave them their all. And, you know, I think a lot of people are going to give you your all when you're that top-ranked team, who especially has been around for, like you said, 10 years of a top-ranked ACC team. You know, they're going to be getting everybody's best shot, and I think Florida State's going to do that as well.
Now more than ever.
Here's my thing about Florida State. I believe that Clemson's going to win.
Tigers. I
got to say that. No. yeah, I. You know, if they were playing Notre Dame, you wouldn't know, right? Who I'm pulling for? But
go Irish. Who do they play this week?
Oh my gosh, they play.
That was a trick question.
No. I don't know who they play.
We should know. I don't care.
They probably a Pac-12 team.
I think they host SoCal this weekend, right?
Yeah, it's probably a Pac-12 team by now.
Yeah, 3-2 SoCal.
Okay, there you go.
At 4-1 Notre Dame. Sorry.
No, you're fine. So, you know, I think it came at the right time, obviously with the bye week. Everybody talks about the past and how well Clemson did or last year after the Syracuse scare, right? Yeah. They won every game by 20 plus points, including the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Some games by 60, you know, talking to, I think 50, 60, talking to Wake Forest, right? Those kind of games. They just blew everybody out, basically.
Ironically, because Wake Forest might be the next best team in the ACC now.
Wake Forest is not going to be a pushover on offense for sure this year. And I think Clemson needs to be aware of that. You know, people say, oh, well, it's going to be a breeze for Clemson, but Florida State's going to be a challenge. Wake Forest is not going to be a pushover either. And then South Carolina is always going to play Clemson tough. It's just the rivalry. That's the way it goes. And they're not a bad team either. I think a lot of people unfairly say that if you're not top 25, then you must be 100th or something.
Exactly right.
And I don't think that's the case. I mean, if you're not top 25, you might be 30th.
Or if you're not in the playoff conversation, then we don't want to talk about it.
Right. And that doesn't mean these are garbage teams just because they don't have a number next to their university. Right. And so I think that they need to. I think that's just a bad way to look at it when you're like, okay, everybody else must be garbage if they're not
Brother,
ranked.
I do too, man. You're talking to the wrong guy. I was trying to get people to watch UCF at Cincinnati last week.
Oh, that was a great game.
It turned out to be a great game. Yeah. I'm not sure if I convinced anybody to watch, but go Bearcats, right?
Right, yeah. And, I mean, there were a lot of turnovers in that game for sure. I think there was also a lot of turnovers in the Miami game too.
No. There were turnovers everywhere this
turnovers
weekend.
In the Duke game. I think there was 10 turnovers in the Duke game.
I'm curious,
it was crazy.
Were there more turnovers this weekend in college football than touchdowns? Let's just say yes and move on, because probably.
I think everybody picked on Trevor Lawrence for having so many turnovers early, but now everybody else kind of catching up with him and throwing interceptions left and right.
Also, everybody getting your best shot, too, right? Mm-hmm. So Tua Tagovailoa didn't have a turnover until LSU. But the problem was, by then, he had hit some defenders in the hand who just dropped the ball.
Right.
Right? Versus Trevor, he hits some guys in the hands and they catch him, and everybody goes, oh my God, what is this guy doing?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I had a guy, Matt McGahey, he's a big Georgia guy who, you know what? I'm sorry, Matt, but Matt wouldn't leave me alone Saturday night when Georgia was losing on the road at Tennessee. Right?
Oh, yeah, that was weird, wasn't it? Almost into halftime losing.
Say, Matt, I'm not just calling Matt out, except that I know he can appreciate this. I got it from about a half dozen Georgia people who, I told you, this is why I can't do this, and blah, blah, blah. And for some of them, I didn't even respond. The rest of them, I said, okay, wait. I love saying that. First of all, the first quarter, you know what it's like. You want to get home. I got to get home for 3:30. The kickoff's at 3:30 or 7:30 or 8 o'clock. No. You can flush away the first quarter of most games. That's when these guys hit each other in the mouth. They try to figure out the matchups. They go to their coach and say, this, I see this, I see that. I can't do this. Let's do that. the first quarter is almost always a wash. I'm not saying don't watch the first quarter, but don't let the first quarter tell you the way a football game is going to go. Unless you're a Tennessee fan, because that's the most fun you've had all year, was beating Georgia in that first quarter. You know what? Go Vols. You've earned it, I guess.
Yeah.
It's overdue. It's about
They needed
time.
That bad. They needed that first quarter win so bad.
Right? And they did. They won the first quarter, and that's all they could do.
And they almost won the first half, but you know, with like 2 minutes to go, they blew it, right? And
then why they call them quarters, right? Because there's four of them.
Right.
Like, no. And I knew Georgia. I knew Georgia was going to dominate. You never know. I guess that's the sincere
You never
truth.
Know for sure.
Yeah, you always hope to get a team's best shot. I'm always thankful when I get to see the best shot from any team, including North Carolina against Clemson a few weeks ago.
Right.
Florida State's going to give Clemson their best shot, too. But they've been trying to give everybody their best shot because Florida State was recently competitive enough for people to still care about beating Florida State.
Right.
They're really not good, and they're getting better. And I don't know if Willie Taggart's the answer. But I tell you what, Dabo Swinney and Trevor Lawrence, that is the answer. And I just... I don't know what the spread is.
It's 26 right now.
I'll take it. Fine. Let Trevor Lawrence and Travis Etienne be mad at their mistakes that they made last week or 2 weeks ago and hold it upon themselves to just go nuts.
And I trust those guys because they've been around. You know, Travis is a junior and then Trevor's a sophomore. I think that...
They're sophomores.
They're both sophomores?
Wait, Travis. I'm sorry. Yeah, right. I was thinking Justin Ross. There's so much talent on this team. It's kind of hard to keep track of how young they all
are. We're done with Travis after this. He's gone. I think he's going to the NFL for sure. But
I'm sorry. I hate to interrupt again.
No, you're fine.
But are you sure?
You can't be for sure.
We said the same thing about Christian Wilkins.
Or C.J. Spiller.
Right? There's a lot of guys that we said that about just last year who were millionaires who stuck around and risked that money. I've seen it happen on that side. Jalen Smith a few years ago, for example, with Notre Dame. He played in the bowl game against Ohio State, broke his leg, couldn't get drafted.
It's crazy.
Right?
And I think it's tough for a running back because it's such a high impact on your body.
Yeah,
I think you need to go early. If you got a shot, you need to go early. Just because of that. Wide receivers, maybe not. Maybe defensive line, maybe not. But I think when you're getting pounded like you are as a running back and the fact that there are not a lot of running backs that are successful over 30, I think it's time to – you need to get in early for sure.
I think if you know you're going to be a top 10 pick, you should go. And yet those guys didn't do it last year. They stuck around and won another national championship. So you never – I say you never know. You tend to know less with Clemson. That's also – you know what?
Well, there's
that
family environment.
If you're listening, Travis, ETNT, stick around. You're explosive. So.
Yeah, there's that family environment, atmosphere that they have that, you know, they care about each other. And those defensive linemen wanted to stay with each other. You know, same thing with Isaiah Simmons wanting to stay and be with Tanner Muse. Those guys are really good friends.
Yeah.
And so those friendships, those bonds that you're never going to get back. Once you go to the NFL, you know, you've got Hunter Renfrow and Cleveland Furl in Oakland or you know, eventually Vegas, right?
Yeah, Vegas.
And then you've got Wilkins down in Miami. So they're miles apart, and so you might not get to see each other. That friendship, that bond that you've developed for so many years.
Miami.
You know, they always say about Clemson, you spend 4 years of your life there, but then the rest of your life trying to get back.
Except for Kelly Bryant. And I only bring that up because I think he made a mistake. I think a guy like that, I'd rather see sit the bench behind Trevor Lawrence and then play back up. Just so that the rest of your life for the next 30, 40, 50 years, you're going to have a blast at Clemson, South Carolina. That's all. Because I see it with Taj Boyd, for example.
And he had a big scare this weekend, you know, with that illegal hit. Man, that was pretty nasty.
Yeah.
And, you know, that kind of reminded me of the heart I have for him because I don't want to see anybody get injured. I don't want to see Kelly Bryant get injured for sure, especially he's doing really well. And at least the first reports are that it's good. He's not going to be out for the season. He came out with a knee brace that was locked. You know, when you can't bend your knee and crutches and the knee brace, you kind of get scared of what's going to happen. Well, I think the athletic director came out today, or the coach came out today and said that they believe he will be able to play again this year, that it might have been just a sprain. Same thing with the Florida quarterback. You know, that was kind of scary.
Oh,
he got bent.
God.
His knee got bent backwards. And I was like, okay, this is done. See,
he
for
was
me,
writhing in pain. That was awful.
So for me, it's really, really hits home because I walked on at Anderson University for a year at soccer.
Okay.
It's something you don't know about me.
Didn't know.
Walked on for a year. I was just a practice dummy. I didn't get any playing time at all. So I'm not going to claim that at all.
Okay.
You don't have to check that. You're not going to see me, you know, on any stat book because I didn't get any playing time. But I walked on and I was a practice dummy. I rode the bench, but then I tore my ACL playing basketball. And so I then...
Intramurals?
Intramural, yeah.
I had to ask.
And played the
You didn't get pushed down by Trevor Lawrence.
No.
Shattered your ACL, turned it to dust.
No, I tore my ACL on, I actually stole the ball and was going for a little Tony Parker kind of Euro move and just collapsed. Then the next year I tore it again, the same ACL. Kind of like Brighton Constantine and Clemson this year. He tore it playing basketball in February, repaired it, and then just a few weeks ago tore it again in drills. And so it can happen. A lot of people say that it does happen more than once. There's a lot of stories of people that I met in my journey of ACL reconstruction and orthopedic doctors that, you know, usually it's not. It's usually the other one. Usually you tear the right one, and because you're favoring the left knee or the left leg, you tear that one because you've kind of developed this habit of favoring the other leg. But that didn't happen to me, and so
I didn't have Amari Rogers ACL surgeon.
No, I did not come back. I actually asked the doctor to give me Michael Jackson's knee, because I wanted to be able to dance. but he was like, "No, we can't do that for you. Sorry." So I had to just get just the regular surgery.
All right.
I still am a very average dancer, but maybe I can practice that, but. It's a long journey. For me, it took a year just to get back to being confident in playing soccer in the backyard.
Oh, yeah.
Because you just, not only you physically probably can do it, but your mind says, oh, no, I can't do that. I can't run that hard. I can't. And I still haven't played rec ball or anything in Greenville recently. I have a lot of friends that still do, and I want to eventually, but, I think that pat has passed me. I'll be a sports talk guy now.
But, good. You're in good company.
But so I understand the injury, and like you said, Amari Rogers coming back as fast as he did was amazing.
It's unprecedented, right? He's an elite-level receiver.
Yeah,
he just tore his ACL. I guess now it's 6 months, so nobody's surprised. But when it was 5 months and he was practicing, just insane what we're doing with sports medicine now. It's incredible. However, I hit my elbow walking past the kitchen door, and I dropped to my knees in pain. You've done this before. We've all done it before. I'm a big guy. I wear a 15 and a half shoe. If I'm not wearing shoes, every coffee table is my enemy, right? And they've won the battle several times, right? I win the war, but those TM tables have won the battle. I don't know how we take for granted that these guys line up face to face and slam each other as hard as they can, right? Every single Saturday. Mm-hmm. We take for granted even the bye weeks and what that means. Again, Clemson coming off of a bye week to host Florida State at home after being ridiculed nationwide.
Oh, man. Beat up bad
there's
in the media.
There's no kind of motivation like that, not even close. However, with that said, I don't understand. Okay, one of the things Clemson gets kind of busted up for in the national media is that they celebrate these wins. Like I'll give you an example. I saw Clemson celebrating a win against North Carolina on the road in Chapel Hill, and people were saying, why are you saying it like this? I can't remember. It's Twitter crap, and I'm talking too much about it, but I didn't see where people were upset about it until I looked. Once I looked, I saw it. Everybody's furious. You should celebrate every single win. I celebrate every single win. I celebrate every single damn Saturday. I'm fortunate enough to watch this sport and to see competition like that. Mm-hmm. I have no problem celebrating any part of the sport at all whatsoever from top to bottom. Mm-hmm. All the time. I wish we did it more. I think we don't celebrate it enough, frankly. But the guys out there battling, to see them celebrate, I want to see more of it. Clemson football does such a, I say Clemson football, official. Their promotion and video and content that they do to show these guys is impeccable. It's second to none. There's more than ever nationwide across the sport, but I do think Clemson does that on top of other things better than anybody else. So I love it all. Sorry about your knee. I'm happy for you, Amari, if you're listening. Don't listen to anything we just said. You're just fine. You're not going to tear it again.
No.
It doesn't happen like that.
Well,
it all up, actually.
I didn't have the top level trainers and facilities that these guys.
Cryo.
I mean, I'm doing it on
stem cells.
I'm over here in a physical therapy office with, somebody maybe that's like 60, 70 working out their shoulder. You know, these guys are in the top level facilities, surrounded by the best doctors and the best trainers, and they know exactly what they're doing, and have the best nutrition too to kind of keep. There, a lot of people ignore that, and that was one thing Clemson talked about this year in fall camp, was just how important nutrition was for them to get faster and quicker to the ball, certain things. And so even though they're actually lighter on the defensive front they are quicker and they're more agile, and they can slip through blocks and get around certain, get into certain areas and chase people down to the outside faster.
Yeah.
Because of you know, they're leaner, you know.
Didn't used
but
to
they're
be
still
that way.
But they're still full muscle, so for sure.
Used to be, it wasn't that long ago.
No.
Everybody on the D line was just these beefcakes, mm-hmm. who couldn't stop eating meat and potatoes, right? No, it's true.
Right.
Now in nutrition, you have these guys who weigh less and are stronger and bigger and faster.
Mm-hmm.
This golden age, I call it, of the sport, I celebrate every single part of it, and I wish more people were paying attention to how much more evolved the sport is. Like, we're all watching Deshaun Watson break records at the Texans, right? Because we're Clemson fans, and mm-hmm. he broke records.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't pay attention to the Texans much before. I wouldn't be paying attention to them at all if not for Deshaun Watson, right? But I think that even the pro level is starting to, as a side effect, if nothing else, benefit from all these guys who are better than ever before in the sport. That's the truth. And it comes from great level, high quality coaching and elite level recruits being capable of listening. I don't like Cam Newton. I know he's a trigger for a lot of people.
Mm.
I think she's very pretty, okay? And sometimes she throws a pretty ball too.
Oh man.
But listen.
I'm not gonna go there.
Okay, but it's hard to teach Cam Newton to listen, right? And Deshaun Watson, you couldn't stop him from wanting to listen. This guy loved game film. He loved tape. He loved to listen to these coaches who loved to teach him how to play better football. Now you're seeing him doing it better in spite of their performance, right? It's not all on him. You can't blame it all on him.
Mm-hmm.
But I hope, and I say I hope, it's happening now, Morgan. We're seeing it. We're seeing these guys. Look, you think Trevor Lawrence isn't going pro? Of course he's going pro.
Of course.
That's going to make the whole sport better to see mm-hmm. these guys. Tua Tagovailoa, I encourage all this stuff. I'm happy to see it. Travis Etienne, I don't know how long he'll play in the league. I don't care. Mm-hmm. He's a good guy to have in the sport. And to see, okay, you mentioned the Raiders before. The Raiders used to be a notoriously atrocious culture, right? Like,
right.
Violent culture. Don't ever take your kids to a Raiders game. That's why they moved out of L.A. L.A. had no football team or pro, say, yeah, just plain no pro football team. They had two pro basketball teams, two pro baseball teams, no football, because the Raiders were so violent. They were nasty. Now you got leaders like Hunter Renfrow and Cleveland Ferrell and Josh Jacobs coming in with the new coach, John Gruden, excuse me. Joe Gruden just got fired.
Jay Gruden.
I don't know. Joe, John, Jay. What was the Foreman grill? They're all George, right? Stop confusing me. But in any case, I think that's kind of a perfect pairing, and I'm sort of optimistic about where that's going to take them next, because they have it looks like a very deliberate goal to sort of have more of a college structure, right? Like you're seeing with Patrick Mahomes in Kansas City.
Mm-hmm.
We're seeing that more again as a side effect, and with guys like, I say guys, girls like Cam Newton, who don't necessarily want to behave that way. It's okay to laugh at her. She's fine. She's not listening to this podcast right now.
I hope not, right?
No.
I mean, you know, a lot of free time right now.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah, you know, I'm not a big Panthers fan. I kind of
Charlotte, North Carolina Panthers, by the way.
Yeah.
I never understood why they call them the Carolina Panthers, except to steal our money here in South Carolina, where we're never going to get a pro team.
I'm definitely the Deshaun Watson fan. I really kind of ignored NFL for a long time because I felt like that, you know, they're just getting paid so much money and their heart's not really in it. And that's what I love about college football is that these guys, you know, a lot of these guys are going to go work, you know, sell insurance next year. You know, they might not get it. They might not get to become a pro, right?
Maybe.
They might have to go become a salesman or work in IT or be an operations manager or something. So these guys, they might be the last time they ever get to play. And I remember the last time I ever suited up. And, man, I wish I could go back.
Oh,
and
man.
So, you know, these guys.
You knew it was the last time.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't think I knew it was the last time for me because this, you know, was the end of the season. That was really the, you know,
sure.
Obviously it's the
we
last.
We see it every year.
I knew, I had a feeling that I wasn't going to go back because, like I said, I was the practice dummy. So I looked at my future, and I told the coach, I said, hey, I'd love to return, but, you know, 6 hours a day practicing and then going to class, it's just not, I'm not going to be I'm not going to play in the MLS, so
yeah.
Let me move on, right? And it was tough to say that, but also, you know, with the knee injury, you know, that was hard enough to come back from. So, but.
Speaking of soccer, mm-hmm. while we're still speaking about soccer, do you care about the Greenville Triumph?
You know, I haven't been to a game yet. Mark Childress is trying to get me to go because
to
he's
go.
Big on it.
Yeah.
He loves it.
They host, there's sort of a collective group here called the Reedy River Riot, right? So it's a fan group. But they get together here mm-hmm. at the Growler House in the Village of West Greenville to watch all the games, right?
Wow.
It's not far from here, Serene Stadium, where they've been playing, right? And Legacy, whatever. It doesn't matter because they're moving next year. So I'm not, I had this problem this morning. It doesn't matter. So forgive me, but go to more GBL Greenville Triumph games. They're terrific. Yeah, I can't believe you haven't gone.
You know, I mean,
I get it. I know how it goes.
This show, sure. you know, you talk about the production of it. Like I said, I wanted a show that looked like you were watching something on ESPN.
And it does look like that.
And that, I appreciate that. Thank you so much, because it takes a lot of time to do that. It took me months to get to that point. And then to maintain it, you know, I'm sitting here like, some people look at it and they're like, oh, they you know.
It looks effortless.
Yeah, effortless,
it really
right?
Does.
But it, you know, I'm saying, you know, just to study, let's say it takes a couple of, you know, I would say 8 hours to study a week. And then to do the graphics and update, maybe 4 hours to do or so, give or take. I kind of like leaned it down a little bit. Yeah. And then to do all the editing, because I have to edit for the Roar. Now when I do the show live on Wednesday night on YouTube and Facebook, then on Thursday night, it goes and gets aired on the radio. So then I have to kind of turn it into a podcast, but also edit it for YouTube.
Real quick, because I want to promote it. What time does it come on the Roar? 105.5 FM.
Yeah, 105.5
Streams
FM.
Streams on the Roar.com.
97.5 on Spartanburg. In Spartanburg.
Okay.
It does stream live as well on their app. It comes on from 8 to 9 every Thursday night. And then the original show, which that's a replay. The original show, or the main show, is every Wednesday night, 8:30 p.m. on Facebook or YouTube, and it's the Morgan Thomas Show.
That's where you want to be. That's where I like to be. I don't know why I get so excited about it. I've never really done the live thing myself, and then I see my phone tells me Morgan Thomas is going live. I'm like, really? I'm doing stuff right now, but I can make this work. Right?
Nice.
And I get on there for about 20 minutes and chat back and forth with people. I think it's really exciting. It's the future. It's the 21st century. You mentioned ESPN. They're not doing stuff like that, right?
No.
They'll read Twitter stuff if you hashtag it right, I guess, but it doesn't work the same way that we expect. This is what I want. I want more people to be able to interact, to answer questions.
Right.
Who, for people like you who know what they're talking about and have done more research than I have, right? I love the sport, and I can't do this kind of stuff. I know you can't every week either, but it's still, it's nice to know that somebody else is out there doing it for sure. I enjoy it. I think it's great.
I appreciate it. I think.
Do you come on before or after 4th and 16 on Thursday?
On Thursday, right after 4th and 16.
Right after that. Okay. So
you'll have Walt Deptula.
There you go.
I think from 4 to 7.
Yeah.
And then you'll have Ellis Tolbert from 7 to 8. And then I'm from 9 to 8. Or 8, excuse me, 8 to 9. 8 to 9, and then it goes to CBS syndicated stuff. But that's what's so interesting to me. Like we said, I started in December kind of as a necessity for work, and here I am, football season.
Passion project.
An hour after Walt goes off on football season, during football season. And I'm kind of like pinching myself, you know, to try to understand how I got this far. But it all started with taking that risk and believing in yourself. You know, Dabo Swinney says you got to believe. He has that sign, that wooden sign, old wooden
Thank
sign,
you.
Says believe. And I think Mark Childress told me the same thing when we talked. We sat down for coffee because he started liking my stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, when he started liking my stuff, the same day, I believe in little God winks here and there, but the same day I was driving to work and he was filling in for Mickey Plyler at 8 a.m. or 6, 7 a.m. And I said, okay, this is that Mark guy that's been liking my stuff.
Yeah.
So I messaged him on Facebook and I said, hey, I'd love to just meet you. And we talked for like 2 hours.
See.
And he said, how can I help you? And I said, well, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm just trying to figure this out. He said, well, go think about it and come back to me. I want you to have a plan. Don't just kind of do it, you know, winging it. Don't wing it. Just try to have an actual plan. Like, think about your vision.
Right.
And so I went home and I thought about it and I said, you know, I can do stuff behind the scenes. I can be a producer for sure. I can edit videos all day. But I already do that at work. So I already kind of fulfill that need.
Right.
I don't fulfill that need to be a host. And people enjoy it and they say I have a good voice. So I came back to him. I said, hey, I'd like to be a host. He said, okay, we'll start getting you FaceTime on the radio, airtime on the radio, and FaceTime on my show. And it just kind of slowly, I got 5 minutes where I could say like two sentences and then he hung up on it. And I was like, okay, I thought I was
on
a big deal.
Show.
Yeah, on his
okay.
show, I called in and it was like 5 minutes as the guest. And I said a couple of things and then he hung up. And I was like, okay, I guess that's my shot, you know. Well, then a week or two came by.
That's
and then,
hard though, isn't it, the radio part?
Right, especially trying to get your thought out in 5 minutes, right?
Well, no, it's not that. You know what I'm about to say. Your five-minute thought takes 25 minutes because you're sitting there on the line, right? They keep you. You're not
right.
like, hey, it's
I was
me.
Waiting,
let's talk.
You know,
it doesn't work
sweating,
that way.
Waiting, nervous about,
sure.
you know, not messing up. But then, you know, it just kind of got gradually. He said, okay, let's do 30 minutes next time. And I did 30 minutes. And then I did a full hour with him in the studio. And then he filled in for Walt. And I did a full hour with him on Walt's like show during rush hour, you know, like coming home from work. And then
road rage.
Yeah, road rage. And
and so perfectly named, by the way.
And it just, like I said, it just kept going from there. And it all started with just, you know, just taking that risk. I think, and that's what Mark told me a long time ago. He said, you know, there's a lot of people who want to do these things. Yep. A lot of people who go to school and get communications major. I've had so many people message me and say, hey, we admire what you do. I went to school for this and don't do it. And, you know, I say to them, I try to encourage them in the sense that, hey, I'm not a communications major. I'm not a journalism major. I'm not even a graphic designer or a videographer. But I just took a risk and I tried it, you know. And so if you think you can do it, I encourage anything, not just sports or radio or whatever like what I'm doing. But if it's anything, you know, kind of what you're doing. If you want to be an artist, you know. Back in January when everything was going down, everything was kind of blossoming, like we were planting these seeds to where we are now. I prayed a prayer that said, and I don't, you know, if you believe this or not, but for me it worked, or at least I felt like it worked. But I prayed and I said, hey, God, if you could just give me a couple of open doors and make it clear, like open a door for me and make it clear, right? And then on the flip side, shut the doors and make it clear. I don't want to be guessing, is this the right way to go or if not?
Right.
And my hope was that he was going to open up like a six-figure job at Verizon for me.
Sure.
That was my thing. I was like, okay, I'm going to say this, but my real hope is that the door number two opens, that's the $200,000 job at Verizon.
Sure.
Right? Well, those doors got shut.
Okay.
Like, those were like so hard in my face. I told my wife, I said, I can't believe this. I'm so frustrated right now. These doors are all being shut at Verizon. I'm stuck where I'm at. And she said, you know what? You asked for this. If you don't remember, you asked for this.
Oh, yeah.
These are maybe the doors shut. And she said, what about the radio stuff? What about Mark Childress? And I said, oh, come on. That's just a hobby. That's just, I'm not making any money off of that,
no.
Right? That's just for fun, you know? And she said, no. Everything that you pursue in that, it seems like you meet somebody new,
yep.
Or somebody gives you a chance to say this or say that, or somebody compliments you or says, hey, keep it going, or they encourage you in some way. And at Verizon, you know, right now, there's doors shut, right? Clearly, you didn't get it. I get those emails. You know those emails where it says, thanks for applying. We've got better candidates, right?
I'll
get those.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I said, you know what? That's the perspective I need to have. I need to stop dwelling on, you know, getting beat up in the corporate world.
Mm-hmm.
And I love, believe me, I'm not knocking Verizon at all. I love Verizon. I enjoy where I work, and it's a great place to work. If you're looking for a job, go try it out. You start from the bottom and work your way up. It's great. But, and they teach you a lot. But on the other side of things, you know, even though it's not, you know, Colin Coward's $7 million a year job, It's fulfilling.
Whoa, is that real?
Something like that, I think, right?
God.
But it's fulfilling me in a lot of ways because I'm able to use it as my talents in a positive way towards Clemson, towards, you know, my friends, my family,
towards you, right?
Yeah, towards myself.
You feel better.
You know, fulfill my desires.
Got to start with you.
Yeah, exactly. And so I didn't know I had these desires, man. 3 years ago, if you would have asked me, I'm on the radio. No, I'd say no way. I was that. I got to be a vice president at Verizon guy. I was that got to climb the ladder guy. I was getting my MBA at Clemson, and I had to do that. And I was going to be suit and tie Morgan, right?
Sure.
And now here I am, not suit and tie Morgan. I still have a button up, but, you know, no tie. And nope, not Clemson colors. I know you're beating me up for that. But,
clearly. Just
but,
a bandwagoner over here.
But, but, you know, to find something, you know, they it's the cheesiest thing, and I hate to say this,
please.
To find something that you love and you'll never have to work, I never believed that because I was like, no, you have to hate what you do to make a lot of money. You know, you have to be miserable and your family never gets to see you, and that's success, right? But I don't really believe that anymore. I do feel like I'm getting a lot of fulfillment and that I sit here and I do my show and I spend 5 hours afterwards editing it and it feels like 30 minutes because I just love it.
Time travel. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm with you there. So, 5 hours though. So it is a lot more work than I thought.
I wouldn't say five. It takes to cut it down to the podcast because as you can tell, I talk a lot. Alan kind of keeps it concise. He's my timekeeper. But for me, I like to just ramble and just keep going. But I like to talk about everything. I wouldn't say necessarily say rambling. I like to have, you know, conversations that go longer than I should.
I don't care.
Than the radio likes. But
yeah, it's a podcast.
The radio is very strict on what you have to have, right? So, you know, what I do is after the show, I immediately go into editing it in Premiere and just kind of cut it up for the radio, you know, render it into MP3. For a podcast style, for
sure.
Three different segments for the radio, and then I send it off to the radio. And then the next day, I'll come back and I'll edit a little bit more for video so that I can throw it up on YouTube and Facebook. So if you missed the live show, because you know the live show, some people don't have an hour and a half or an hour to watch a live show. Some
on
people
a Thursday?
Like to.
This Thursday,
or
I'm
Wednesday,
gonna be...
Yeah, Wednesday night's the live show, but Thursday's the radio.
But Thursday, I'm not going to be listening. I might tune into the Roar just to try to hear Syracuse at NC State this Thursday, right? Isn't that this Thursday? And instead I get gifted with you followed by Ellis Tolbert? No way. I'm just going to stay there and listen to commercials. That's another thing, by the way. I love these commercials. You know, Zach Orr?
Mm-hmm.
Did you know Zach?
You know what? That's the only guy at the Roar I haven't met.
What?
I never met.
Okay. Good, because I never met him either. You can tell who he is. You can tell how good he is and how much he cares about a lot of sports, including hockey, which... For what it's worth, nobody else talks about around here.
Right.
I'm literally next week, I'm going to get to talk to people in the hockey here with the Swamp Rabbits. I'm really excited about that. I don't care that nobody else wants to hear it. I really want to hear it. There are some fans here for sure. Zach Orr just left.
Yeah.
I hate to hear that because I just thought he was so great. But I never met him. And that's another example of another guy who just... I remember when he was... I can't remember who was before him with Mickey. But Zach and Mickey in the morning, I just... kind of broke my heart to hear that he was leaving. So he got married, and now he's leaving.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Louisville, right? Or somewhere
that's
in Kentucky.
Warning right there for all you guys out there. You know what I mean? You could have a future in Clemson radio or get married to someone you really care about. Take your pick.
Yeah, that's
I'm not trying to throw him under the bus. You can't ignore that stuff, though. You have to make fun of him for that, right? But I miss him. And here's my point. You still hear him doing commercials, right?
Yeah.
So I hear Zach Orr trying to tell me about his security system or where to get my Honda service. I'm like... Can't you just please do remotes? I used to listen to... First of all, radio is sacred to me. I've always loved radio. I don't know why. I grew up in Cincinnati. I had, like, Marty Brenneman doing the Reds games back with the Big Red Machine and Pete Rose and Barry Larkin and all of those guys back on the team. Boomer Esiason. Chris Collinsworth was our local sports guy. He did high school football coverage for the local NBC affiliate.
Are you kidding me?
No, that was just how I grew up.
Wow.
So maybe I was preconditioned to sort of love the radio.
Yeah.
But I listened to K-Rock for years. I still listen to it. One of their co-hosts of their biggest show, Kevin Bean. Bean lives in Seattle, right? On the other side of the continent, right, so to speak. And he's been doing remotes for the better part of a decade. He's about to retire.
Wow.
But Zach Orr can do remotes? Come on, buddy. I don't care where he's moving to. I don't know where he went. Do you know where he went?
I think Louisville.
Louisville.
Yeah,
Louisville.
I think, or at least somewhere in Kentucky, I believe.
Louisville, because he always said that, too. Louisville, like you're having a stroke when he talks about the car.
I will say, you know, I love Mickey, but he was kind of... You know, saying Mr. Orr 24 way too much. I kind of got annoyed at the Mr. Orr 24. What do you think, Mr. Orr 24? Like, can you just call
Twitter.
Him Zach?
It's Twitter. You have to do the Twitter thing. I'm still kind
of
new to Twitter.
I guess self-promotion of Twitter.
Look, hell, we met through Twitter, right?
Yeah, right.
So this is proof positive right here that Twitter can be good positive.
So you just need to call me Clemson Morgan for now. What's up? What do you think, Clemson Morgan?
Clemson Morgan.
I think it's a little weird to call somebody by their Twitter handle.
I think it's I don't have a problem with that, especially if you know who they are. It's different when you're trying to hide, you know, like when you don't use your real name on social media. I have a problem with that. I just don't talk to those people very much, right?
Right.
But it's a whole other universe out there. You can create a brand off of that stuff, too. I'm glad you don't do it. Like I said, I'm not going to talk to anybody who doesn't at least put their name behind what they do, because the 21st century, there's just nothing to be afraid of. Look, I say there's nothing to be afraid of. The stuff that you've done that you were just talking about, all of those things are tough. They're challenges. They're challenging.
Oh, yeah.
They're things that you are afraid of and are anxious about. But the point is you do them. Just you mentioned Dabo. That's what you're supposed to do. Be objective. Do your best. I think a lot of people just don't play and want to do their best because it's scary and they're anxious. And nobody else out there is a really good example of them. I didn't know you did all this stuff, Morgan, so thank you for sharing that. But it's a sincere surprise, and I guess I shouldn't be surprised, except that that it comes from Twitter, that I can meet people that way.
Yeah. This is, isn't that crazy?
I'm talking too much because this is a best case scenario for me. Yeah, it's crazy. It doesn't make any sense, and yet here we are. The 20% is good for all of us.
And I hated Twitter. You know, I was a big anti-Twitter person. But
I avoided it too.
But, you know,
we talked about Formula One before. It's so great for Formula One with live timing and scoring and all those reports, replays and stuff like
Formula
that.
Formula One does really well. NBA, Clemson football, like you said. There's a lot of places that just don't take advantage of it. Like we're talking about, radio shows don't take advantage of it for whatever reason. I think nightly news is actually starting to get into it.
Yeah, it's
with their individual analysts. You know, I like seeing individual analysts do their own page and kind of control that. I think that's really makes it more personal for when you're watching those. Because a lot of people when they see those nightly, oh man, that's Carol Goldsmith. Oh
can
man,
I say
that's
this
John
about
Sessler.
You? Yeah, and I know a few of those people, mm-hmm. and you know that's part of their job now too. In fact, including if you're on radio, that's part of their curriculum. They have to do it.
Right.
Like that when that becomes part of it, you mentioned if you were having to do that for Verizon. Then it becomes way less engaging, way less fun.
Right.
However, a lot of people I've learned on Twitter, you can't tell if they're joking or how much they're joking or if they're completely 100% steadfast serious. You can't tell. I say that, and I'm looking at you, and that's the difference. I can tell with you, right? Okay. And I think that's important, right? I think Dabo Sweeney, one of the things he preaches about is be impeccable with your voice, right? It's one of the four agreements that I follow that we won't get into all that right now, but I think it's important, right? And I don't think it's too much to ask. I don't think everybody needs to do it, but I'd love to celebrate the people who do. You do a good job of that. Ellis does a great job of that. Ellis Tober at 4th and 16. Mark does a good job of that. Mark Childress.
Mickey Plyler
does a good job of that. Zach Orr. Well, Zach Orr does a lot of good jokes too. Mr. Orr 24. I had to say it again, so now people know who to follow, right?
Right.
But you can't ever really tell until you start to develop a pattern of consistency with how people communicate. And that's the problem with Twitter is you can't tell until you find that pattern.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for having that pattern. Thank you for being consistent. I don't
it's hard to be consistent, though.
Yeah, but
it's
you
really
have an
hard.
Opinion. And that's
Man,
all you
hard.
Really need is your own voice, and you have it.
Because
you haven't even had it for that long, and here you are.
There's all kind of analytics about it, you know, with social media marketing. And that's kind of the job within the job, right? So I started out doing the video editing and things like that on my own, and then for my job, and then got in front of the camera and started doing live streaming, which really I kind of learned through watching video gamers of all things. You know, video game market on YouTube and Twitch and Facebook is crazy.
Yeah, celebrities.
I mean, like
legit.
you're talking hundreds of thousands of viewers live to watch other people play games, which I thought was weird to me because I was always like, well, if I'm going to play a game on my PlayStation, I'm going to do it myself. I don't need to watch somebody else do it. But then I started to notice like, okay, these guys are really good. Like, they're not just your average guy, like your friend that you go sit on the couch and you're bored. These guys like know what they're doing. They're doing it really well, whether it be football or you know, city building or whatever game it is.
It's true.
I started watching the graphics
Force
and
management.
Stuff. Yeah, and I started watching the graphics and stuff, and I said, okay, well, what programs are they using? So I started researching that, and I started using the programs that the gamers use, and nobody really does that. Most people, what they do is, you probably noticed it, they'll get on YouTube, and they will have their camera on their coffee table, and they've got their hat backwards, and they look like they really just kind of rolled out of bed. And for me, I didn't want to do that. I wanted to... You know, I wanted people to say, well, these guys are part of the ACC network that's coming, you know, the new ACC network. I wanted them to kind of think that was the case. So I made sure my backgrounds were nice. I made sure that I was clean, you know, clean cut and looked nice. And
the background's very nice.
Thank you. And it's all green screen. It's all, you know, I photoshopped in a, you know, studio background and put it in there. But I took the time to do that, where a lot of people just kind of throw up a camera. And it works for them sometimes. You know, a lot of people are very, very successful in that style.
If it helps you feel any better, I don't like that. I don't like to see some guy with his cat run in the background and knock over a plant. He's just like, oh, get it later. I can't stand that stuff.
So I take pride in what I'm doing, but it takes more time to do that. But then, like I said, then people see like you, they say, okay, well, these guys actually care about what they're doing. They're serious about it. They're trying to actually
do their best.
They're actually being, and that's opened up doors that I think there's that this negative connotation of, oh, you're a YouTuber. You know, you just that guy in your mom's basement. You know,
I'm not. So people say that to you?
There's no, nobody said that to me because of the way I look. But then there's, you know, there's always that perception that, oh, you're on YouTube, you know, but
like PewDiePie or something.
Yeah, yeah. You know, but I mean, there's some really good, I mean, like that he's like, you know, one of the best, right?
Sure.
In gaming.
But he doesn't do green screens and stuff.
Right. And so I think that there's definitely a balance between you being yourself. And not everybody can do that. I've seen some people try to do Clemson stuff where they're like me, and they're like a where they're like me and they have a show and they're very structured and it just doesn't work for them because that's not their personality. They can't really host it like that. Their skills aren't that set, right? And but then if they go in their man cave and they're just kind of off the cuff, man, it works great.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you need to keep doing that. That is you. So at first, be yourself. Be what you want to be. But then, you know, take a risk. Try something different. You know, put yourself out there. No matter what job it is, like I said, even if it's not radio or sports, even if it's just podcasting about cooking or something, you know, just take a chance.
Or bronies. anything. I don't care. There's a niche market out there for bronies. I don't care what it is.
You know, I had toyed around with a lot of different ideas. I mean, I enjoy, my wife's going to say you should never say this, but... I enjoy WWE. You know, I like wrestling. I like it because...
Wait a second. Aren't they about to come to Greenville, first of all?
They are.
Yeah.
And my dad and I grew up watching it, you know, in the Hulk Hogan, Ric Flair days, right, when they were, on top of their game.
I'm a little older. I had Ultimate
Warrior. Yeah, you're Ultimate Warrior, I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah. Sergeant Slaughter.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. So that was a little bit before me, just a little bit. Not too far, though. We're not too far apart. But I was definitely like the Hulk Hogan age, and then when Hulk Hogan turned heel and he became Hollywood Hogan, I was, I think, in middle school, I was depressed for like 2 weeks.
Oh my God, because it hit
of that. You. Yeah, it hit me. It hit me hard. Me and my dad both. We used to watch it like every Monday night. And the Monday Night Nitro and everything, you know, and WCW, they were all kind of South, born in the South, and TNT and TBS, Ted Turner, you know, and the Braves. Oh, yeah. And so when that happened, I was like, oh, no. So I like to watch it because, man, if you watch it now, man, what a production is it? I mean, there's graphics, there's 3D, there's announcers, there's play-by-play, there's color.
They're still superstars.
They got a lot of stuff from a production standpoint, the lighting, the cameramen, the different angles. And so I watch that stuff kind of like as a student, just kind of, okay, this is how they're doing this. This is how they're doing this graphic. This is where they put this. This is where they put that. If you really sit back, there's a lot of Netflix videos, movies that I watch where I'm like, okay, I used to watch Daredevil. I think they kind of stopped that. But Daredevil on Netflix, I love that.
Those long, uncut scenes, these fight scenes, just choreographed perfection.
Haunting of Hill House, or I think that's what it was, the horror, right? That there were a lot of scenes where, if you go back and look, there were no cuts. I mean, these guys were remembering their lines, memorizing their lines, and it was like 15 minutes of straight memorizing of lines, and it was everybody. I mean, you're talking five or six characters on a scene, and there's no stopping it, and they all work together, and the lighting was perfect, and the camera moved. And if you really go rewatch certain things and you look for that stuff, it's kind of cool. But
that's preparation.
Yeah, for me though, I mean, I didn't learn any of that stuff traditionally. I didn't go to school. So if you're somebody, I got to go get a degree. No, you don't. You just learn it on YouTube, especially the creative world. I think the creative world is more accepting of people who learn it on their own, because even my cousin, she went to Auburn. And she did graphic design in Auburn, and she loved it.
Okay.
And she was just like a straight A student. She was way better student than me. But she went to Auburn and Photoshop, InDesign, Illustrator. She had to learn those things herself. Just because you get a degree doesn't mean they have like Photoshop class.
Oh.
They teach you the concepts and they make you do projects and different
so they give you the access
stuff.
To it. Gotcha.
Yeah, okay. But and they give you the access to it, but they're not going to go say, well, this is how you cut a player out of a background, you know, or a person's hair out of a background.
And you can find that for free on YouTube right now.
You really can. I mean, there's so many people now. I mean, you think about people who back in the day were photographers. I don't know how they did it. I mean, because they didn't have videos to go watch to figure it out. They had to like spend thousands of dollars on film to figure it out, you know. And for you, like thousands of dollars on paint, hundreds of dollars on paint to figure it out, right?
More to your point, photographers had to go into a dark room. So you had to schedule time to do that because you didn't have your own, right? You had to schedule you had to prioritize your gear, all your equipment, every piece of paper you were going to print on. Thank God we don't have that anymore. Look, my style of work is about to be, I'd say vanish, but... You're holding the cell phone in your hand that's going to take a better picture than my professional camera in about 5 years. We won't need professional photography the way that we have for the last 100 years or so.
Right.
We just won't. Mm-hmm. And so you have to adapt. You have to learn. You have to grow. You have to challenge yourself.
Especially with the mirrorless cameras that they have now with the Sonys and things like that. I mean, you're looking at cameras that basically getting as small as your smartphone anyways. So they're kind of like competing. They're going to eventually, like you said, going to be competing with each other because there's going to be cameras that, you know, fit in your palm of your hand that are you could use at a wedding.
You know, you can use them now at concerts, at every single concert.
Right.
We see it.
Well, we debate about the concerts. We debated about that earlier.
But the problem is now those cameras are starting to take just as good. Like, actually, I want to see your camera phone pictures because they're that good, right? The camera phone.
Unless
like
I'm sitting
new,
close. I don't want to see the guy in row 800.
Sure.
You know, I don't want to see your shots.
Oh, yeah, you say that, but my buddy Matt, he just got the brand new iPhone with three cameras on it, and I don't know exactly how any of that stuff works, except it takes an incredible photo.
Yeah.
So, like, I was all weekend, I was at Albino Skunk Fest, where you can get real close. You can get right next to the bands, right? Mm-hmm. So I kind of understand more about people wanting to capture it. Number one, because you can get stuff so close. Number two, because the performances are excellent, right? They really are unique. It's not like, oh, I went to a live concert and it was cool. It's like, no, I go to a lot of live concerts and you need to see this. This guy literally had his drumsticks. He's hitting the wall. You see these signs over here? He is literally hitting like metal signs hanging on the wall like that. I'd never seen that at Skunk Fest.
Yeah.
So I understand when the camera phones come out for that stuff. So you sort of have to adapt and film stuff differently. However, with that said, it's kind of like what you were getting back to with, if you're listening and you think you want to do this and you think you have a voice, the honest truth is the only person who's stopping you is you. Okay, if you want to produce a podcast, call me. Hit GBL Media up online, gblmedia.online. Hit me up on Twitter. It's Color of Gray, G-R-E-Y. Hit Clemson Morgan up.
Yeah.
It's called Clemson Morgan.
Yeah, I like that. I appreciate that.
We'll,
I like that.
We'll tell you everything we know and hook you up with however you want to do it.
And I've already
and
had a couple of people. Yeah, I've already had a couple people say, a guy reached out to me. He said, hey, I want to do some videos and some analytics on high school football in the upstate.
Good.
And he said, I have no idea how to do it. I really want to be able to do it. And when I messaged him back, what I had at the time, this was before I had sponsors and before I had like top line equipment, which I really don't have the top line equipment. I can still improve. You can always improve equipment.
Yeah, right. Well,
but when I started out, I had a $45 webcam and a $45 mic. And he was like, is that all I need, really, to have the show you have?
Right.
I said, well, you know, the graphics and stuff are Photoshop and my like skill with editing. Sure. So I can't say that you'll have that, but you can at least have yourself in front of a camera with a show. Now I've since upgraded the cameras and the mics. But
you can't use that as an excuse.
No.
Price.
I mean, hey, my first show, the one I was telling you about in December before the Notre Dame game, I had... I don't even know what megapixel camera it was, but it was terrible. I mean, I won't even show anybody that video anymore because it was so grainy. If you're a friend of mine on Facebook, you probably can already see it, but because I didn't delete it, but it's there from back in December. And I mean, it was you could barely make out who I was because it was so grainy. Now, you know, obviously I have a better camera.
Sure.
But even, I mean, phones can only really see like 720, so you don't need a 4K $10,000 camera.
I heard Joe Rogan do a podcast on his way back from a show on the PCH, right? He's literally driving through California recording it on his phone. Quality wasn't incredible, but he was still doing a show.
Yeah.
There's no excuse not to do it. If you really feel compelled to do it, do it.
And motivation, like I think Zig Ziglar says this, like motivation comes from doing. So you just got to you gotta take a chance, do it once, try it again twice, and before you know it, it'll be a habit, and you'll be motivated to do it every single week. Like for me, I can't imagine myself not doing it.
That's why I'm glad you're here. Do you have any potential future aspirations for this stuff? Like, obviously, I'm sure you want to keep doing it as long as Clemson's successful, which seems like it's going to go on a long
time. Cash in on that, right?
No, it's true. Well, I mean, in no uncertain terms, yeah, why not? I have no problem with that. If that's what you were doing, I wouldn't have a problem with that either. I've seen more people participate more because of Clemson's success, right?
Definitely.
More people going there, more students. I'm happy for all of it. I celebrate it.
I wish that I would have started earlier simply because I have been a fan for so long.
Right.
My dad and my grandfather had student tickets, or not student tickets, but they had season tickets, rather. My dad and my grandfather had season tickets, and so I went as a kid. My grandmother used to have me out in the we used to park at Little John, and you could kind of see into the stadium from Little John. This is before the West End Zone was the big deal.
Before.
And so I could play cars, and my grandmother could see through the West End Zone like wedge there in the corner. And you could kind of tell, and you could hear the PA at the time because it would echo out through the stadium. It's not as enclosed as it is now, more of a horseshoe right now. But
they keep the Wi-Fi in. Thanks for the free Wi-Fi, Clemson. Well,
and you know, I get a lot. No, people know I'm at Verizon, so they get a lot of complaints about the. But I'm telling you, they spent millions of dollars on cell signal there.
I guess they have a bunch
of different repeaters on top of the stadium. I hope it's a lot better. I know a lot of people have said in the past that it's not good, but
sure. But that takes time to develop, and you know that.
Oh yeah,
but it's I wouldn't call it a problem now at all.
You talk about 80,000 people in the stands. Think about how many people are partying outside the stands. You know, like at their tailgate. I mean, it's a lot of people on their phone, especially when with you got the interference of, you know, direct. Everybody has a direct TV now.
Absolutely.
You walk by every tailgate, everybody has a TV, which I remember as a kid. I mean, you know, there was you were listening to the radio. That was it. You were not watching anything. And I remember starting to see people watch stuff. I'm like, oh man, those guys must be rich. They got a TV. And now it seems like everybody has a TV and direct TV hookup. But and sits there for 12 hours cooking breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Right. But I mean, that's what it's all about. I love that. My dad took me. My grandfather took me. And then when he passed away, I took over his spot and kind of, you know, sat with my dad. My favorite memory, you mentioned this to me earlier, my favorite memory
as a Clemson fan.
As a Clemson fan, really, I have two that were really most important to me. And, well, I'm going to say three now, because if you're a real Clemson fan, you got a million of them. But my youngest, so I have different points in my lifetime, right? So as a kid, I remember my favorite memory as a kid is the catch two with Rod Gardner. My dad and I were there.
Oh, wow.
It was like 32 degrees, right? It was freezing cold. And my dad and I were sitting next to each other in section G, row double X, section G, and on the 25 yard line. And I remember having a blanket over me because it was so cold. And I don't know how old I was. But definitely not in high school.
I was going to say, it wasn't September 2019, let's put it that way.
Not in high school. And we're watching the, you know, he gets the catch, and I mean, the stadium just erupts. And then they kick the field goal to win it, and it was just, we just go nuts, right? And I just remember hugging my dad and being there moment, that family, you know, feeling, and just, I'll never forget that, right? And just being a little kid, high-fiving adults around me was so cool, and winning in the last second. Well, then... I would say when I came back from Iraq, my first game was the Clemson Florida State game. I had 2 weeks after returning from the desert, I go to the Clemson Florida State game.
What year?
2008.
Okay.
And it was thunder and lightning, and it was when he got that Superman pose where the Florida State guy James Davis is pulling on his jersey, and it's like pulled so far back it looks like a Superman cape because he slips him and he goes for the touchdown and they win, and it was a ranked versus ranked game, and I sat on the 50 yard line. I got a ticket last minute. I didn't even have tickets. I got a ticket last minute from a guy on a moped, and it was amazing. You know, like I said, I had just been, you know, a year in Iraq. I mean, and the previous year I was in Iraq with a bunch of Clemson and Carolina fans, and we were watching it on this really, really small TV, and they lost that game. So I had to listen to it from them for the rest of the deployment. So then when we came back and won, I felt so relieved. Then I would say I've been on the field with a friend that had had a rocket go through his leg in the Army with me, and he got awarded a Purple Heart for it. And he got for the Florida State game with Taj Boyd and Jameis Winston in 2015, I believe. Uh-huh. He got honored at halftime on the 20-yard line. And he didn't have any family members here. And so he asked me to go. And I was, like, so honored by that. I got to sit on the sideline with the ROTC the entire game. Now, I'll tell you, the game was horrible because they lost, like, 53-14.
I remember the game.
But we were at the field goal post as they were running down the hill. Hmm. And I'll never forget that. I mean, just being there and running down the hill. And that was like Heisman Trophy candidates like Boyd and Winston, you know, fighting. It was College Game Day. And it was the big deal, but we got destroyed, you know, unfortunately. But the pregame and the buildup was awesome. And then the national championship game, man. The national championship game.
I'm sorry. Which national championship?
Well,
game, Morgan?
I'll tell you. I went to both. Actually, I didn't go to the third one. I didn't go to. There's three. I didn't go to the San Francisco one with Trevor Lawrence.
Okay.
I could have stayed with a friend in the military that was in San Diego.
You don't have to explain that. That's fine. But that's a commitment.
I didn't go. And when you go back to back, I mean, it was like a couple of grand each time.
Oh yeah.
So I went to.
You're a loan officer.
I went to Phoenix, Glendale, and. We went to Vegas. Crazy story about that. I got a ticket the last minute, and I was supposed to go Charlotte, Chicago, L.A., Vegas. That was my trip because it was the cheapest thing I could find.
Oh.
And I get there, and they say, we're sorry. There's a bunch of Clemson fans there. They say, we're sorry. It's snowing in Chicago. And I said,
I've had that before.
You're gonna have to go tomorrow. I said, I can't go tomorrow. My friends are waiting on me in Vegas, and they've got a rental car, and they're going to be going tonight. And so I'm in line, and there's all these Clemson fans, and everybody is like, oh, we have no tickets to Glendale. We have no tickets to Phoenix. We're sorry. So the people just start peeling off, like, we're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry. I get to the front of the line, and I tell the lady, I say, hey, I don't need to go to Phoenix or Glendale. Because she looked at my Clemson gear, and she said, you got to go to Phoenix or Glendale. Sorry, yeah. Right? She was going to tell me sorry again.
So you do have a Clemson shirt. I'm just making sure.
I have a couple. I have a couple. And I get up there, and I say, hey, I need a ticket to Vegas.
Right.
She looks at me. She goes, Vegas? I'll get you there a direct flight.
I love Vegas.
And I said,
you can get to Vegas anywhere, all times. Oh,
and I said,
Vegas.
You mean to tell me all these people that you just turned around that were Clemson fans,
yep.
You told them no, but because I want to go to Vegas, you told me. And so my flight, that was like a 12-hour flight.
You can fly from here to Vegas.
Oh, man, yeah, it's crazy. And I mean, and so I got there in like 3.5 hours. And I got there, and they weren't expecting me until like 1 a.m. I got there at 7, and I ate dinner with them, like in Vegas, and then we went to the Grand Canyon.
I thought you were going to just have this crazy story about showing up in Vegas on your own 5 hours early.
No, you know what's crazy about Vegas, though? Like I felt like...
I live there. I love
it. They pump oxygen, right? That's the story, right? They pump oxygen in these places. So I went to Caesar's Palace, and I was up to like 6 in the morning, just walking around everywhere.
Yeah.
And then we went to the Hoover Dam, which was awesome. We went to the Grand Canyon.
Great.
So it was cool in Vegas, and then it got a little bit cooler in the Hoover Dam, and then it was like 8 inches of snow at the Grand Canyon, and I got like 2 feet away from a deer. Like, it was crazy, and I'm like, man, this is nuts. I've never done something like this. And then I get to Glendale, Arizona, 95 degrees.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And I'm like, wait a minute, it was just like 2 hours ago, it was 8 inches of snow. You know, and so that's what's interesting about Arizona. But, you know, we ended up losing that game, which is a game I still to this day, and even Dabo will admit, without that onside kick, they would have won the game because it changed the time of – it changed the possession. And so it caused Clemson to not be the last team with the ball. And it gave – and then they scored immediately after that onside kick. So it also let them go back up, and then they were going to have the ball last. So it ruined the entire game, that one play. If they would have just had – a player.
See, that one play could have gone either
5 yards
I mean,
over to the left.
It's an onside kick.
Dude.
It's never, like an onside kick to me isn't a 50-50 thing, right? It's 60-40.
Oh, no.
You're
oh,
not
no.
gambling on yourself. You're but losing the game. That's why
they kicked
it
in the right spot, the right distance, the right hang
had
time.
The right
catch. It was just so perfect, man, for them. But Clemson had the momentum, and then it just killed the stadium. It really did. And then, you know, obviously they lost, and we, you know, kind
and then
of,
Roll Tide.
But it was great because it came from Phoenix.
Can
and
you
so
say Roll Tide?
I'm not going to say that.
You're not
I'm going to say Roll Tigers, maybe. Phoenix, you know, the Phoenix, right, coming out of the
yep.
ashes, right?
Sure, yeah.
And so I think that was a symbolic thing. So I go to Tampa, and my idea, so I got a ticket for Glendale for like $20. But
what?
The plane ticket was like
from another
1,000.
Moped. I got to find this
right.
guy.
I keep finding these guys. I got a ticket for $20, but then the plane ticket was $1,000.
$20.
Yeah, because I mean, you know, it was one of those things where like plane tickets were filling up, so Clemson fans couldn't get there, Alabama fans couldn't get there, so the ticket prices started plummeting towards.
Was it $20?
Yeah, it was crazy.
Okay,
it was crazy. So I get to Tampa and I think, oh, you know, tickets will be cheap, right? I ended up having to spend $1,500 on a ticket get there, right? But on StubHub at the time, it was 30 minutes before the game. And Alan beats me up about this every time we meet because Alan offered me a $600 ticket. And because it was three rows from the sideline,
yeah.
I didn't want to be that low to the sideline. I wanted to be up a little bit higher. So I was like, I'm going to hold off.
Plus you were broke.
And I mean, I obviously had enough money for four times that, but two and a half times that,
you
right?
Pick your battles.
So I get to Arizona, and for 4 hours I walk the stadium, and nobody has any tickets, and there's a bunch of counterfeit tickets that year, and so my wife is sending me pictures of counterfeits because there's so many people getting duped on Facebook, and so I'm watching, and so I'm like, okay, this is fake. Sorry, see you later. And then I finally met this guy, and I told him, I said, hey, I'm a Clemson student. I'm an Army veteran. All I have is $1,500 in my pocket. I'll show you what I have. I showed him my cash. I said, if you can find me a ticket. And he says, come walk around on this other side of this car. And I thought, oh, man, I'm going to get beat up or something. Well, I walk around on the other side of the car, and he says, I can't let my handler, like the main guy, because this is like, you know, under the table.
Sure.
You know,
oh, yeah.
And so he's like, I can't let my main guy who's getting all the tickets know that I'm going to sell you this ticket. He said, but I'll sell it to you. I said, well, will you walk with me to the gate? And just to make sure it's real, you know, before I give you the money. He said, yeah, sure, I will. And he said, I showed him my military ID.
Okay.
Because he kind of like help him out, you know, show him that I was telling the truth. And he was like, okay, I want to hook you up, man. You're a vet. I want to hook you up. So I go to the stands, and 30 minutes before the game, the ticket works, and I hand him the money, and I run, and I'm like way up in the nosebleeds. Go figure.
I don't care.
You know, but I could have had a ticket really close, and Alan always beats me up about it, but for a lot cheaper. But
was Alan there?
Alan was there. Go figure. We were there in Vegas, right? Remember I told you? You know, we're talking about Vegas. Yeah. He went to the roulette at Planet Hollywood.
Okay.
And
off the strip.
Yeah, way off the strip. Went to Planet Hollywood, a roulette, and won $5,000 there.
Oh, all right. Not bad.
So he paid for our dinners, by the way, so I didn't have to pay for the hotel dinner.
He had to pay tax on that.
I don't know. I don't know about all that. But
yeah, I think it's over $2,000. Yeah. I love Vegas. Sometimes you have to wait. When you win that much money, you have to pay tax.
But you know, it was a great experience. You know, I would, if I could give anybody any advice, it would be if you see a national championship ticket for $600, just buy it. I mean, come on.
So the playoff games are in Atlanta and Glendale, is that right, this year?
Well, they rotate. The championship game is in New Orleans, right? And
but one of them's in Atlanta, and the other one is three time zones away. That's all I remember. I don't remember which one is which. That's why
I think it is in Glendale.
Like,
again.
So, for example, Clemson is not ranked number one right now, right?
Yeah, they're number two.
I say probably. It would depend on a lot of other things happening for Clemson to become ranked number one.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't remember which game that means they're likely to be in for the first round of the playoff.
Yeah.
With that said, I don't know that it matters because Clemson fans traveled to San Francisco in Legion, you know, so I'm not worried about it.
No, I wouldn't worry about the fan.
Not worried about it at all.
I will tell you, I think that it's going to be hard for Clemson to get back to number one because, Alabama is going to have a tough schedule. They got to play LSU. And they've got to play Auburn, obviously, which, you know, Auburn is what it is. And then if they make it all the way, they got to play the SEC championship game.
Georgia.
Against Georgia or maybe a Florida. We'll see. You know, we'll give them a chance. But they definitely have a harder road. I don't think there's going to be definitely can't be two undefeated SEC teams. So that's a positive for Clemson. The negative for Clemson is that Ohio State, I'm starting to really believe in them right now because
Morgan,
they're doing really well.
You're not alone there at all.
I didn't believe in him after Nebraska.
A lot of people didn't. That's okay. I get it.
And I thought that was an overhyped game. But now, after
but
what
Michigan
they
State,
did to Michigan State.
Now people believe. I get it.
I feel like that the fact that they're so balanced, when Fields doesn't have to throw it all over the place because J.K. Dobbins can just run it all over you. And J.K. Dobbins is really having the year that we want Travis Etienne to have.
Exactly right.
And so you gotta give Ohio State some credit. I can see where Herb Street and Pollock and Fowler are saying all high things about Ohio State because, you know, if you look at their schedule, I mean, they got to play Wisconsin. But, you know, I think Wisconsin's going to play them tough. But, I mean, Ohio State's just so
and
powerful.
And Penn State.
Penn State is definitely one of those unranked team or undefeated teams that don't get any love right now. They're undefeated right now. They don't get any love right now, and so, they've got a game coming up, a big one, I think. I believe they have to play Iowa, I think next, pretty soon. So,
I didn't write that one down.
But
maybe they're off.
But again, like I said, Clemson is in the best situation to be undefeated because if they can beat. If they can get the running game going the way it needs to be going, I mean, I don't see them really being tested very much in the ACC all the way to the championship game.
There should be some fun games remaining.
But they can't sleep on Florida State, Wake Forest, and South Carolina. But still, and then eventually, I guess, Virginia maybe? It's hard to tell with the Coastal. The Coastal is so all over the place right now.
Is it though? Like, I feel like it's safe to say I think Virginia is probably a good lock for the Coastal. But then again, they're at Miami, I guess that's this weekend.
Yeah,
that's
Miami this weekend,
right?
Yeah. And see, that's the thing. Like, Miami, you know, they're supposed to be good, but then they're terrible. They put in their backup quarterback, and he throws for almost 500 yards. It's crazy.
And they have great tight ends, and nobody's paying attention to them.
And then you got Duke, who does great one game and then turns around and loses the next game. And like I said, then you got Virginia Tech, who wins a game out of nowhere. You know, their coach is on the hot seat. And I think the Coastal Division is just so volatile right now. You got UNC that –
Volatile,
you know,
is a good way to put it.
They almost beat Clemson and then turn around and, you know, didn't really – didn't really seem to stop Georgia Tech very much. I mean, Georgia Tech, a team that just came off of a two-point game against Temple, but then Georgia Tech scores 22 on UNC. It's weird to me how the Coastal Division is. It's not as clear as Clemson, you know, and I think Clemson obviously is going to be the favorite in every game they play this year.
Sure.
But it is definitely interesting to see how everything's going to shake out. I think for Clemson fans and for Clemson themselves, they just need to do what Dabo Swinney says. The next game is the only game. It's the most important game is the next game. And just play that game
and respect
and focus
that
on that. Yep. And then let all the other chatter and everything else go. Just work it way out, because these teams have to eventually play each other. And somebody's going to come out a loser in that sense. Same thing with Auburn and Florida. We just saw. Everybody. I had so many people tweeting me saying, oh, how dare you pick Florida? How dare you? And I said, if you look at the matchups, though, Auburn, all they do is a jet sweep. Auburn doesn't trust Bo Nix. Bo Nix got lucky.
Rightly so.
Got lucky against Oregon. Florida has 26 sacks on the year and can stop anybody. Their defense is amazing. And what happened? I mean, you got to look at the matchups a little bit and not just say, oh, well, they're undefeated. You know, and we're starting to see, like, Texas A&M.
I didn't see it that way myself. I hate to interrupt, but I saw what Auburn – I think a lot of people said, well, Bo Nix isn't that good. And I was one of them, in spite of the fact they were winning. They were winning because of their pace. They were finally evolving into Gus Malzahn's pace. And it was sort of –
which is like a spread jet sweep option. It's kind of weird.
It's just nobody runs the hurry up like them, and I think it's disgusting. I think it's kind of an insult to the sport the way they, oh, we got a first down, hurry up, get over. Oh, stand up as straight as you can with your hands on your hips and stare at the sideline. They get coached to do that. They get timed with stopwatches about how fast they can run, stop, stand, and turn. That's dancing. That's not football. So that's personal. I totally get it. It's within the rules.
So I guess you don't want me to bring up Texas A&M being down by three scores and still running to the 2 second left on the game clock. I don't understand that at all.
I don't know
they
why.
They did it against Auburn. They did it against Clemson.
What were they
you're
waiting
losing.
For?
Yeah, what?
If that's
why are
your
you
competitive
waiting,
advantage,
why are you milking the clock when you're losing?
I digress. Auburn was having their success because of that pace. That's what it looked like to me, rather than Bo Nix. Bo Nix completed, I think, 11 out of 24 or 27 again this weekend. He seems to complete 11 total passes every single week.
Mm-hmm.
He's not an outstanding quarterback. He's not supposed to. That's not why I expected their offense to flourish.
Right.
It's because they were getting the timing right, and he's the stopwatch keeper for that timing, right? But they were letting him throw. He threw three interceptions in this game, and that at some point that becomes on you and your coaches, not just on your freshman quarterback. I didn't get to see any of this game, Morgan. Thank God I was at Albino Skunk Music Festival having way more fun. My buddy, who's a huge Auburn fan, he goes to every Auburn home game. Mm-hmm. In fact, the only reason why I got to see him Friday is because Auburn was playing on the road this weekend at Florida instead of at home. He would have been there in Auburn for sure. But I thought it was going to be a blowout. Not because of Florida's – look, Florida's defense is great, but it's their secondary that's truly elite, right? And their pass rush, which, okay, those two things don't matter if you're not relying on your quarterback, which is exactly what Auburn, of all teams, did. And I'm like, okay, Auburn, you deserve this loss. That's how I feel about it. But I did not – Florida is 6-0. 6-0.
Yep.
Okay, Alabama's 5-0. Mm-hmm. Ohio State, I guess, is 6-0. Is that right? Clemson's 5-0. Georgia's 5-0. A lot of these teams have not played six games.
Not yet.
I don't know. A lot of people were saying Florida was already overrated. I don't know where to rate them now. I still don't know where to rate them.
Yeah.
And it'll play itself out. You know?
I think they have a top 10 defense, but I'm still iffy on the offense. They cannot.
Yeah.
They broke a big run, but they have historically, or at least for this season, had a difficult time running. So it was interesting to see
two big explosive plays.
Yeah, it was
to
interesting
find
to see them do so well on two big explosive plays. You take those two away, I don't think. You know, it was that big of a game for them. But, I mean, you know, anybody can break something at any given moment, if it works out.
Except Clemson at Chapel Hill.
Yeah.
That was my whole point last week, was just one of those plays, and we wouldn't have been talking about it.
And I think that's what Clemson relied on a little too much. They relied on that one play. They just need that one play. And thankfully they got it from T. Higgins, a big play to go ahead and, or, you know, take the lead late in the game. But the big play from Travis Etienne has been missing, for sure.
Who's your favorite Clemson quarterback of all time?
Clemson quarterback of all time. Well, I'm going to say Deshaun Watson. He's my favorite. because of the what he did with a
–
you
caught me off guard there.
With losing and I mean, I've been through like Brandon Streeter and, you know, I've been through Charlie Whitehurst and Woody Dantzler, which yeah. Alan would say Woody Dantzler. That's his favorite.
Okay.
But Charlie Whitehurst beat the Gamecocks 4 times in a row. But Deshaun Watson, just the fact that how he won the national championship, he didn't have as many weapons as this team does, or the team last year had. And he had to do a lot himself, kind of like the way he's doing with the Texans right now. But he's just a great kid.
Oh.
You know, he's just a wonderful human being. He's got a wonderful family. And he doesn't let the fame get to his head. He's still super respectful. I met him at a recruiting dinner when he committed. And they do a recruiting wrap up. And it was at Jervey Athletic Center, you know, Jervey Gym at the time. Now it's at the big Allen Reeves complex, the indoor facility complex, and there's thousands of people there. At this time, there was only like 100 people there, and they were giving away barbecue. Now it's like thousands of people in Chick-fil-A. But Deshaun Watson was like maybe 170 pounds, 80 pounds. He was so skinny.
Okay.
But he was dressed like it was a job interview. He just looked clean cut, perfect, and he was so respectful. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Shaking people's hands, taking pictures.
Yeah.
The moment was not, you know, he was just so humble. You know, he wasn't like too big for the moment. He knew that he was the new kid, and he knew that he had a lot to learn, and he was willing to learn. Like you mentioned earlier, he loves to be a student of the game, and he's still doing that. And he knows that he's very talented, but he doesn't tell everybody he's talented. He's not your Cam Newton that likes to show everybody that he's talented or prove it, you know. And so I met him, I shook his hand, and I thought, man, this guy is going to be the next big thing, right? He's the 5-star QB. And at first I was like, but he's so skinny.
Yeah.
You know, but he came back the next year and had put on a ton of weight, and then just the passes that he could hit, and he's kind of has that Tim Tebow about him, where he may not, he's way more talented than Tim Tebow as a quarterback, but he has that
triggered some people there, Morgan.
That winning ability. Like Tim Tebow could just win a freaking game for you. You know what I mean? Like if you needed him to win a game, he could win a game, and he was great for the sport of college football, and so was Deshaun Watson. And that's what I love about Tim Tebow. I know he's polarizing, and I know I'm on the type that I know he can't pass the ball really well, but the guy won a playoff game. I mean, how many quarterbacks do you know that can't really throw the ball very well win a playoff game? Also being left-handed, you know. But, I mean, he's basically a tight end, playing quarterback, winning a playoff game.
I'll never understand that stuff about the pros. Like,
yeah, I wish that he would have stayed in.
Taj Boyd isn't still playing pro football at some degree, right?
Yeah, and I think Taj Boyd, I love him.
He's my favorite, for the record.
He, other than the 4th and 16, struggled in winning some of those really big key games, you know. The Florida State game, for example, he struggled mightily at home at that game. And there were a couple of other times where obviously West Virginia, you can kind of blame that on Kevin Steele like everybody else did.
Okay. That's fine.
But yeah, I mean, there's you know, you
he's
can
a
say,
champion without a championship. I
right.
love Taj
I mean, Taj Boyd is definitely that. And I think there was that was missing a little bit from him because he had the wide receivers. We can't say he didn't. He had Andre Ellington, which, you know, was an NFL caliber running back. But Deshaun just had that ability to win games. I mean, when you saw him win against Florida State, dropping a dime to, I think, Deion Kane and driving them full length of the field all the way down to win the game. And then winning games against Lamar Jackson, you know, just a shootout back and forth. And then knowing
the defense won that game, by the way, which is my favorite thing.
Knowing that he could have won the national championship, and he had it in Glendale, and then being able to come back and then do it in the last second, and just I remember Jalen Hurts running it in with 2 minutes to go, and the Alabama fans around me were just jumping up for joy.
Really?
And I remember looking at my best friend next to me.
All the Alabama fans I knew said, there's too much time on the clock. There's
well, that's
much
what
time.
I'll tell you. Like, the Alabama friends around me jumped up and down.
Yeah.
But I looked over at my friend John, and I said, John, I said, look at Deshaun. You could see him on the bench. Just like, you could just tell. I mean, I was in the stand. I mean, I was up in the upper deck, but you could just really tell. Because Raymond James is a great stadium. But you could just tell he was ready. He was going to, and I was like, you know what? Deshaun has done this time and time again. And for him to just march down the field and do that and lay his body on the line. And Mike Williams had some great catches.
Jordan Leggett had some great catches.
Deion Kane had a great screen play, and he's from Tampa.
I hear the radio call of that final play every single day, right, before the press box.
Yeah.
But that whole drive is sort of why we have a podcast, right? The play is what people remember, but that drive was such a stamp on that entire season.
Yeah.
It was incredible. Mm-hmm.
And you know...
That's, again, like I said before, that's how you want to lose.
Yeah.
If you're going to lose, you want to lose to a team playing like that. Mm-hmm. I don't care what your team is. That's how you want to go out.
And now that play, that ending play, legal or not, depending on what side you're on, but now everybody uses that play in crucial moments. Oh, that's the Clemson play. You know, where they cross each other and the quarterback rolls out and dumps it.
Deshaun and Coach Sweeney called it a pick, so let's just call it that. I think what the problem is, people get triggered because they're like, oh, a pick means it's illegal.
Illegal, right?
First of all, it doesn't. But let's say it does. Let's say in no uncertain terms, it's a pick and illegal. I always still thought that that was brilliant coaching, because that's when you want to throw against the ref for a pass interference call, mm-hmm. is for the game-winning play,
right,
however it goes, in the national title game, whatever league you're playing in.
You got to
think
they're going to swallow the whistle on that one, right?
That's good coaching.
They're going
to
let them play.
That's what you get paid to do, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what, you want to take the penalty and give us another? No.
One more shot, right? Yeah.
Okay, but it was flawless. So even if it was the worst case scenario, is it's brilliant. So I celebrate. Again, that's what you want to see. That's what
so
I want to see.
People ask me all the time, like, do you think Trevor's going to beat Deshaun? Well, I think... For me, my thing about Trevor is that he's so blessed with what he has around him, and being able to benefit from what Deshaun and CJ and Taj had all built. I would say that Trevor is going to have to win. I would say he's going to have to win this year and maybe even next year for me to even think about it. But still, trophies in a cabinet are one thing. Like I said, Deshaun is just a different type of person to me, you know, just because
we talked about Taj never won a title.
Yeah,
and still, he's an important part of.
He's
this
an important
program.
Person, yeah. And so CJ, same thing. CJ is always going to have a special part of my heart.
Sammy,
and so I know Trevor is a wonderful person, and he got a great family too.
Cole Stout is an important part of my heart. The way he beat Oklahoma.
I mean, for Cole Stout to do that was pretty spectacular. Yeah. I mean, talk about miracles on the football field. That was something nobody expected.
That guy got booed by his own fans, man.
I might have
and
been
I
one of them.
I hope we never see Stout. That again. Yeah, I get it, but I just hope we'd never... Look, Chase Bryce isn't playing that way. If something, God for... If a panda bear comes out of the woods and mauls Trevor Lawrence in a freak accident because he's carrying around a gallon of honey that he happens to drop on the sidewalk, right? I don't care what it is. If Chase Bryce goes in there, I don't expect him to play... With the same results that Cole Stout said, I'm trying to be real careful about how I say this because I love to see those guys compete.
Yeah.
Cole Stout had it in him, and the way he ended his career with that huge win against
Oklahoma. Oh, it was a great, great end.
I can't ever forget that stuff. I'm not the best memory guy, Morgan. I forget a lot.
Oh,
but there's
either.
Moments that I can't ever forget, like 4th and 16, right? Mm-hmm. And I remember against LSU. I remember the bowl game against Ohio State. And that was a nosebleeder. Everybody was beating the hell out of each other. Like that game, somebody was going to die. That's what it felt like. And to have the balls to think that you could go for it on 4th down, deep in your own territory, to try to have a chance to get a field goal on New Year's Day. Like, it was everything about it is stacked against you, and we're just not going to quit. North Carolina gave Clemson that 2 weeks ago, mm-hmm. and I can't – I know we're talking about it too much, but I can't help but get excited for it.
Mm-hmm.
We've already talked way too much. Can we just real quick cover some of the games this weekend?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, let's start with Clemson. Clemson hosting Florida State.
Right.
Tell me how it's going to go. Who wins?
Well,
and don't say Seminoles.
No, I'm not going to say the Seminoles, good. That's for sure. I'll go ahead and tell you Clemson's going to win, in my opinion.
Hot takes.
but I, you know, they've got to – I know everybody's just banking on that rebound game that, oh, we're going to go on a tear now, 20-point wins every single game. You know, Clemson and Florida State played a blowout game last year. Clemson just destroyed them. But Clemson's won 4 in a row. Mm-hmm. And the other three, though, were close. Were within 20 points or less. Some I think, around 10 points a winner. So I think Florida State, with the fact that they have found their quarterback and Hornibrook is doing well for them, I have a feeling that they're going to have a little bit of momentum. That's about all they can count on is momentum, because their offensive line gave up 8 sacks. against NC State. And so I have to think that Clemson can do the same. So there's going to be a lot of Clemson in the backfield. They only had 57 yards rushing, I believe, and a lot of that was because of the 40-something minus on the sacks. But Cam Akers did have 83 yards rushing. Here's my thing. I think with a 3-3-5 defense, you got to have a good rushing team like UNC had. You got to have two good power rushers like Williams and Carter to be successful against Clemson.
And Chaz Surratt.
Because of that, oh yeah, well, I mean, you got to have an amazing guy that played. Who would have thought he would have played a guy who was a former quarterback play better than Isaiah Simmons that game? I mean, I would have never thought that. But, I mean, he played out of his mind.
Yeah,
he did. His stat sheet was out of this world. But I would say, and I gave him the $2 bill on my show, which is like the best of the opposing team. But we do helmet stickers for our team. $2 bills, you know, because you give them away when you go on away games.
I don't love helmet stickers. You can do that. That's fine.
But so I think that the fact that Florida State leans heavily on their passing game, yep, and the fact that Clemson is just so good in the passing game, and their scheme 3-3-5 is more leaning towards a passing game and stopping that, I think that Clemson's going to be able to stop them pretty well. Now, I do feel like that Cam Akers is a really good running back, but they really don't have a second running back behind him. And so, and their offensive line is terrible.
He's tough.
And
yeah,
so,
still
I think Cam Akers is one of those guys that Clemson went after. And he ended up going to Florida State.
Akers is the place to be. I just love that song.
But I'll say that I don't, with what Clemson came out of with UNC game, and the fact that there's a little bit of a blueprint, and the fact that there are a lot of things that Clemson shot themselves in the foot on, I'm not going to just bank that this team can do exactly. This is a completely different team. I can't bank on that Clemson's going to do exactly what they did last year and just wipe everybody clean, you know, for the rest of the year after this one tough loss. Now, I want to bank on that. As a fan, I want to. But when I really think about
it, I'm about to.
I don't think that Clemson is going to. I'm talking about the spread.
Sure.
I don't think that Clemson is going to beat them by 27. It's 26 right now. They got to win by 27.
Yeah.
I think that's largely undervaluing
Florida State. Yeah, it's
27
tough.
Is tough in an ACC divisional matchup.
Yep.
Florida State is not going to want to just get rolled over.
What time is the game? Is it 7?
3:30.
Is it 3:30?
Okay. And they're not going to want to get rolled over, and they're not going to want, after winning two games against two, I mean, Louisville's not a decent team, but NC State's a decent team.
I just realized this, and I hate to interrupt again. Mm-hmm. This weekend is Fall for Greenville. Are you coming here?
Are
you going to go out?
Well, I can work it out, yeah.
I'll be at Fall for Greenville all three
days.
A lot of people don't. A lot of people avoid it.
It's a lot of people in one main street. I mean, it's not a lot of walking room.
There's
awesome.
So many great games for college. Look, this past weekend was the worst ever, and it lived up to that hype, if you can call it that.
Yeah.
The worst football ever was played with the worst matchups ever, right? Mm-hmm. There were more turnovers than ever. I'll stop. But this weekend has a lot of great games, including big sort of perennial matchups, like rivalry games, right? But being in downtown Greenville, you can just pop into a bar and watch a game or pop into a sports place, whatever, and see the score. If you hear the crowd erupt, I remember watching North Carolina State against Clemson a few years ago when North Carolina State won on a field goal. Oh, wait a second, Dabo Swinney iced the kicker, called his timeout. He missed the next one, so they go into overtime. The crowd's going nuts. I said the crowd all over downtown Greenville was going nuts.
Ooh, that was a tough
game. I was watching at Max Speed Shop down in the West End. I think it was the first play in overtime. North Carolina State throws an interception.
Yeah,
Clemson basically wins. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But this weekend, look, the reason why I bring it up is if you're a Clemson fan and you're coming downtown, I recommend it. Go anywhere. Go watch the game with a bunch of friends. It's going to be a lot of fun. Just don't go to Ink and Ivy at 3:30 p.m. because that's where the Alabama people get together on second floor to watch the Texas A&M game, which was going to be College Game Day, and now I believe it's Florida at LSU, which is a night game. But again, once again, Clemson and Alabama are playing their games at the exact same time against respective conference foes. So just be aware that that's what's
And there's also going on. Wisconsin at Michigan or Michigan State at Wisconsin, is at 3:30 as well. So a lot of big time games all at the same time.
Oklahoma and Texas, the Red River. Which one is the?
Red River rivalry,
or shootout.
You got it.
I can't remember which one you're supposed to say. It doesn't matter. We say them both. Red River Shootout Rivalry.
Something like that, right?
It's at
the
Cotton Bowl.
Yeah. And I've actually, when I was in the military, we were stationed in Fort Hood. And I actually was on the Red River back in 2000, 2008. I was on the Red River during that game, watching the game with a bunch of people on a marina. So it was kind of cool. But I can't remember who won that game. But, it was, you know, before I was into sports as much as I am now.
I don't mean to upset anybody here, including you, Morgan. But I thought at the beginning of the season that the Heisman was Trevor Lawrence's to lose. And I feel like he's kind of already lost. And that's okay, at least for this year.
No, he definitely needed at least 300. I think my stats, if you look at statistically, he needed 300 yards passing per game. And he definitely didn't need 5 interceptions.
Yep.
And now he has games with less than 300 and 5 interceptions. He's out of it. Also, ETN came out strong with a big-time rushing game against Georgia Tech and then just fell off the planet, you know, after that. So I think how many yards did he have against Georgia Tech? I think it was like I want to say the team had 200 maybe, or maybe he had 200.
I don't remember.
But he had an amazing
game.
That's
why I come to you.
I think it was 205. I think either he had 205 or the team had 205. I think it was had 205. And but then after that, he had like 40-something and then 80-something. And so he's kind of fallen off the face. He needed at least 170 yards per game throughout the whole season. Same thing with Trevor Lawrence. He needed 300 yards plus per game whole season, minimize the interceptions.
Once again, thank you. That's one of the reasons
why
I come to podcasts and broadcasts like yours.
Right.
Because I don't do the deep dives to know those.
And I'm not the analyst.
Sure, but
Alan's
the numbers. It still works. I love it. So thank you. Ohio State at Northwestern, you know, Hunter Johnson has been terrible. And I hate to see it, but he's just been real bad. Ohio State, I've got kind of sort of my unanimous number one team right now. I think everybody's just trying to catch up to look that competitive on offense, defense, and special teams. There's something special right now. Northwestern isn't going to change anybody's mind either, but there you go. It's another good conference matchup this weekend. Florida at LSU I think is huge. Two undefeated teams. That's hard to beat. That's a night game. That's about as good as it gets. Washington at Arizona, I don't think anybody really cares about nearly as much. Nebraska at Minnesota, that's an interesting one that I've got because Nebraska, I think nobody really knows what they are. Everybody has an opinion. Like, okay, when they lost to Ohio State, they're like, yeah, I told you Nebraska wasn't good. I'm like, well, that doesn't really answer that.
Yeah.
But at Minnesota, who's undefeated, I don't know who to pick here. I guess Minnesota. I guess we have no choice, but nobody's going to want to watch that game for other games like Clemson and Alabama playing at the same time. Ole Miss at Mizzou. Michigan State at Wisconsin.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see that one.
I think that's one that I'm interested in because I think Wisconsin has a really good defense. I think Michigan State has a really good defense. Obviously, Jonathan Taylor is on a Heisman run.
Jonathan
He's the guy
Taylor
that's definitely killing it right now. I want to see him, see how well he can do against Michigan State, a little bit better of a defense to try to stop him there.
I hope so.
You know, I don't think Wisconsin's going to escape the Big Ten without a loss, but I feel like that'll be a really good game. But the unfortunate thing is, that's going to be a replay. That's going to be one YouTube TV. Going to have to see another one because Clemson's going to be on at the same time. So I'm that's not going to be a priority. That's going to be definitely maybe a channel changer during a commercial.
I disagree because Wisconsin's just going to beat them so bad. It won't matter.
You think so?
Yeah, I really do.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, can you imagine?
So maybe
being
I don't even worry about putting that on my recall. I'll just leave it.
If you were look, we mentioned before when I hit my elbow and have to drop to the floor because it hurts so bad.
Uh-huh.
Michigan State played Ohio State last weekend. Now you're going to play Wisconsin? That's two lunch pail defenses. That's not fun at all.
No, it's not. It definitely not.
You don't want to do that. I don't want to do that.
Especially with that running back like that, it's going to tear you up.
Oh, my God, yeah. I'm trying to think who else we got. Memphis at Temple? Nobody else cares. I love it. I love the Americans, and I talk too much about it. Memphis killed La Monroe last week. Toledo at Bowling Green State University. This is a personal one for me. Because that's like...
you're really digging for me on these.
Well, okay,
I didn't have Toledo and Bowling Green on my radar.
Bowling Green didn't score a point last week. Okay, but Toledo, it's like... I was about to say Spartanburg to Greenville, but they're actually closer than that. They're like 22 minutes apart, Bowling Green and Toledo. So these are all the same guys, right? These are guys... They're probably brothers on the respective football teams playing against... Like literal DNA brothers playing against each other. I don't know if that means it's going to be any sort of any good football. In fact, it probably doesn't. But whatever, there it is. That's the kind of stuff that I want. Like, if you said Bowling Green, did you even know that was in Northwest Ohio? You didn't. Did you know where Toledo was?
I did because I have a friend. His wife graduated from there, and then she got her master's.
She sounds like a babe.
She got her master's degree from Clemson. So Big shout out to Brad and Tiffany.
Okay, there you go. She does that. If she was smart enough to go to Clemson, she's obviously pretty good looking. Hawaii 4-0 at Boise State, another undefeated team, 5-0.
Okay.
That's a
Is that one of those Pac-12 after dark games?
Yeah, it probably starts at 11 p.m.
It does, yes. It's 10:15 p.m. Oh. Yes, so that's going to be an after dark one for me. I'll probably – you know what? I think John Hyde has mentioned this on the radio, and Zach Orr have all mentioned, like, the Pac-12 after dark stuff. I actually like that.
See? I'm telling you, dude. It's like Maction. No, you don't want to admit it, but it's great. It's good for you. It's good for the sport. And nobody else is around to see it.
No, nobody else is watching. Everybody's asleep, so you're like, okay, I'll watch Hawaii.
But you wake up the next day, you know, sleep in on Sunday, and you forget to tell anybody what
you saw. And I watched the California and Arizona State game.
Okay.
And that's when they lost their quarterback, unfortunately, Garbers. But
that
was a good game.
I mean,
it was
it got hurt. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I thought that California should have won, but you know, and then I think Cal and Oregon was a tough one too. I thought I picked Oregon to win by the spread, and they didn't win.
Me too. Yeah. But, the less we say about the Pac-12, maybe the better. But
yeah, I think we're losing viewers on the Pac-12 because nobody stays awake for that. They really should do something for them. But, you know, the football is just not as good, I don't think.
Well,
really.
They just said that players can get paid in California now. Maybe that'll be the catalyst. I'm not kidding. Look, you were mentioning the ACC network. That's going to not pay cash to the players, but a lot of these players are going to benefit from the extra, and no uncertain terms, just plain extra revenue for millions of dollars for these teams in the ACC. All of them are going to benefit from it. Look, the ACC is down. I think we can all realize that.
Yes.
Worse than it's ever before, in a sense that, like, you have these blue bloods like Florida State. I say blue bloods, but you know what I mean. Florida State, Virginia Tech, Miami. We expect to be competitive any given year, right? And instead, they sort of look really bad right away. The ACC network is especially going to help everybody else, but I think it's going to help them a lot initially right away. I don't know when. I don't know how long we start to see results from that, but I'm hopeful. I don't think it can stay this low as long as it has for too much longer. I just don't think it will. That's not natural.
No, I don't think so either. I think they're making the right moves with the right coaches. Say what you will right now about Jeff Collins, but I think he's the right move.
Yep.
I think Matt Brown is a great move. I don't think Manny Diaz is a good move, really, to be honest.
But, I don't want to trigger anybody here, but what if North Carolina had beaten Clemson?
Mm.
They would have given Mac Brown a Monday
lifetime
morning
contract.
What does that even mean? Right? Because he's in his 70s. No, wait, is he in his 70s yet?
I think he's in his 60s. If you,
you
know,
but you don't give 60s. Him a 10-year contract, right?
I don't guess so.
Unless you beat Clemson at home in your first year, like maybe they would have. I don't know. They would have given him something,
right?
And I applaud it.
Yeah,
but you didn't win.
No, 1 point. You know, it's a math game, not an art game.
All right, 15 undefeated teams, Morgan. How many of them can you name off the top of your head right now?
15 undefeated.
You'd be surprised how many are.
I saw this on Twitter.
I'll give you a hint. No Pac-12 teams.
I'm gonna sneak it in. All right. So let's go through the SEC, and I'll just kind of go conference by conference.
Smart.
So we'll go Alabama.
You got it.
Florida.
Yep.
Georgia, LSU.
That's four.
I don't think that there are any more undefeated teams in SEC, so I'm going to say that gives me four. So then there's Clemson, of course, Oklahoma, Ohio State, Wisconsin, Penn State.
Penn State, one of the more quiet undefeated teams out there. But now you're digging.
Okay, now I'm at 9.
Okay.
All right, I'm losing my conferences. So,
if you were a Clemson fan, you might like the ACC and other teams that compete in that conference.
Is there another undefeated ACC team?
Well, relative, maybe.
I mean, the only undefeated team it could be would be, I don't think. Did Virginia lose a game? I can't remember.
They lost at Notre Dame last week, yep.
Oh, yeah. So Notre Dame's obviously got one loss, but I'm at 9 right now.
Okay.
So I know you said there's no Pac-12 teams?
There's no Pac-12 teams that are undefeated.
But you did say Boise State. Boise State, Florida State.
Go on.
Beat Florida State. So you did say that. I'm cheating off your paper here.
There you go. That works.
I think you said Hawaii.
No, they've got one loss.
No, you did. Okay.
But it's going to be a good
matchup. So I'm at 10 now. Is there any other teams that are undefeated? And you said the American Conference. I think Cincinnati has got a loss, right?
They lost a couple actually. It was bad against Ohio State.
I think that's as far as it got. I got 10. There's right. Five more.
Fill in the blank. Blank Forest.
Okay. Oh gosh. Come on, Morgan. You got to be kidding me. You got to be kidding me with this. Wake Forest, of course.
Wake Forest. You got it. Newman. That's right. Okay. Yeah. Fill in the blank again. So Appalachian 11. Blank.
Okay. Tech University. All right, so Appalachian State, wow, undefeated, really. Everybody beat up UNC for losing to them, but they're a good team.
Wisconsin, Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I didn't say Minnesota.
Baylor.
Baylor is definitely one that I wouldn't have thought of.
Baylor's coach, Tom Rule. Is it, mm-hmm. no, Matt Rule? I think it's Matt Rule.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, Dabo Swinney is an anomaly. He's a very special sort of critical guy who never coached. He was never really a coordinator or anything. He just became a head coach. Matt Rule was coach at Temple. Nobody paid attention to him.
Okay,
I've talked about this a lot with a lot of other people. I think Matt Rule might be that next great coach because I think he's such... What Dabo Swinney was a winner. I say was. He still is. What he can always win at anything he does. Selling real estate, selling commercial, selling... beachfront properties, selling whatever, residential, it doesn't matter. He'll win. No, it's true.
He did sell property, by the way.
And he was the number one guy in the state. Not all that dissimilar to South Carolina. You got beachfront and you got Metro in Birmingham, and he was the best. Matt Rule is that guy, and maybe we forget Baylor because of how bad that was. Baylor had some real big problems. It wasn't just football related.
Oh, man.
And Matt Rule is the right guy to clean it up. Like Ole Miss. What is his name? Luke. Doesn't matter.
Hugh Freeze, Matt Luke. Right?
But I think I'm talking too much about Rule at Baylor, but I'm happy for his success. I don't know how much longer it lasts. They host, who do they play this weekend?
See, that's the kind of stuff that Ellis Tolbert's so good at. 4th and 16 podcast. I love the guy.
Can we say that real quick? You've got to listen to the 4th and 16 podcast with Ellis Tolbert.
Funny story. He and
talk about deep dives. What he did last week with the bye week.
Oh, man.
Leading up to Florida State this week. I can't wait. That's when I will literally turn into live radio that isn't live to hear what he's going to say about that. So go on.
Well, funny story, small world. I had not known Ellis at all, but he went to high school with my wife at West Oak.
Okay.
And they both, I think, went to homecoming coming together. So it was kind of neat.
Oh my God, they used to date.
Well, no, they just went on the.
I just wanted to say
they went together. I don't think they dated, but they just went together for that event. All and right.
I love the way he talks, by the way. He says folks. I don't know why I love that word, but I do. Listen, folks.
I love Ellis. He's so the type of guy. He's kind of, I can't compare myself to him because, like I said, I'm the host, producer type person.
Not supposed but
he is that analytic. Like, he'll tell you every offensive coordinator and defensive coordinator and head coach for every team in the FBS.
He's my cheat sheet.
And I'm like, you got to be kidding me, Ellis, right now. Like, how do you know that? And then he'll say, like, he would have said,
he does the work.
Yeah, he would have said the Baylor coach off the top of his head, and he would have told you the past three places he coached and where he coached high school, and he would have told you his fundamental playbook and everything. Like, Ellis is just so great with that.
Name the only three teams. Can you name any of the three teams with no wins right now?
No wins?
This is kind of a dick move.
Man, right? This is hard.
Can you pick any
of
them?
I didn't know I was on a game show.
This is too much fun.
No wins at all? I want to say...
This is a little bit of a loaded question. There's only three of them.
There's only three. It can't. I don't think it can be. Are there any in the Power Five?
No.
Okay. Yeah, that's gonna be hard.
Rice.
Oh, you know what? I should have known Rice.
A football team from Texas.
I just heard about them talking about it on the radio.
New Mexico State.
I think Rice has a chance this weekend.
New Mexico State is one of those teams that needs to just be eliminated, and we give them money because now you're having Oklahoma and Alabama playing week three instead of New Mexico State at home, right?
Oh, and that reminds me of something. I'm going to hold my thought, but you tell me the third person. I'll tell you my thought.
Akron.
Akron.
Oh, really?
Huh. Yeah. You would think the Zips would be better than that. Come on, Zips. Come
Good
on.
Good job. Yep.
we were talking... there was a thought I had about, I'm just going to throw this out there.
Sure. Let me have it.
I would love to see, and I think you'll appreciate this.
Okay.
I would love to see college football mm-hmm. be like Premier League with relegations. okay?
Yeah.
Because, you know, we're always like, well, UCF, like, oh, if we were only in the Power Five, right? So that situation, no. Right?
Yeah, I'm already out on that one.
And
because I believe they controlled their own destiny anyway.
Okay. But they are limited by their schedule and certain things. I would believe this because they plan them out so far in advance. They're limited in a lot of ways. But I'll say that if I think that it would be really neat to have, say, and I don't know how it would work, but have like the bot, like you have five of the group of five and you have five of the Power Five. Why don't you have like the worst Power Five or worst team in every Power Five that year get relegated down.
Okay.
Get relegated down, and then the group of five get promoted, the best of the group of five. So, for example, maybe we let Georgia Tech go this year after this year. Say, Georgia Tech, sorry, you're rebuilding. Go rebuild in the American, and we'll bring in Cincinnati.
Rebuild in the American?
Yeah. We'll rebuild in the American, right?
No.
And we'll let Cincinnati come in. And coming to the ACC.
Now
let's
I'm with you.
Let's see what Cincinnati can do for a year or two. Maybe you don't do it every single year because I know there's a lot of people, like marketing and sales people kind of beat me up
it's
right now.
It's complicated.
It's way too complicated. I know this is like far out there.
Sure, I'm with you though.
You know, you start getting all these posters that cost millions of dollars to put up there with their conference on there and then you got to change it all. But it would be neat to be able to say, okay, you know, if you're just going to suck it up, you know, let's bring in a group of five guy in here. Let's see what they can do.
North Dakota State, and they were kicking everybody's butt.
Now, North Dakota State, are they in a group? They're in the championship division, right?
Yeah, but I don't care.
So they got to move up a little bit more.
Sure.
So my point is,
they earn their place.
Yeah.
Sure.
So kind of like, you know, hey, let a Crystal Palace come in. Let them work their way back up and beat a Man U one time, Man City one time. You know, I think they did actually upset somebody this year.
That's what it takes.
So, you know, I think it's like something like that. I would like to see. You know, not be so locked into, okay, these are the schools. And I know people are like, oh, no, but we're going to lose Georgia Tech. I'll tell you a thing I don't like about college football, at least with Clemson related, is that they have to play Georgia Tech every single year. Let's open it up and let's have two random or two rotational coastal teams and not just lock us in to Georgia Tech all the time.
Right? I mean, but every team has, you know, Clemson played Furman last year, which was terrific. That was one of my favorite games ever, and that doesn't make a lot of sense to a lot of people. But I was on the field. I got to take pictures of Trevor Lawrence's first touchdown, Justin Ross's first touchdown on the first team to go 15-0 in the college football playoff era. Like, it was, were you at that game?
No.
That game was unhealthy hot. It was dangerous.
Yeah, I'm trying to stay away from the 95 degree games right now.
Oh my God.
You know, I enjoy the, because of the show now, Alan refuses, like he goes to every single game and he beats me up about this on the show all the time, which I'm fine with it. But I actually do like flipping the channels and watching other things and pausing the Clemson game and coming back. I do
especially
like
now when there's more competition and it looks great in high def slow motion. I can't blame anybody
for
that.
And there's a lot of you can kind of cheat a little bit, you know. I mean, Sean McDonough and Kirk Herbstreit and Chris Ballard, they're going to do their work, and so I can listen to kind of their takes. And I love their podcast too. Herbstreit and Pollock have a podcast Monday, Wednesday, Friday, which maybe one day I'll do Monday, Wednesday, Friday. I can only contribute to Wednesdays right now, but it's a tough work when you have your own job, you know, to do it. But yeah, their podcast Monday, Wednesday, Friday is really good, and so there's just a lot of stuff you learn from watching it on TV that you wouldn't learn if you were sitting there in the stands. And I'm not a big deal. I'm not big on, you know, sitting there in 95 degree
but especially
weather.
When it's the Chanticleers, right? Or the Paladins. No, and I totally get it.
No knock on Furman.
No, but every team has those. Every single team has a game that, frankly, and I call replaceable.
And I'm not saying that you get rid of those games because I think you do need. No, I think you need. I'm going to tell you. We're not debating.
It's complicated.
We're not arguing. We're just goofing off. But I think you do need like some warm-up games, some preseason, if you will, type winnable games. I think you need those to work some of the kinks out because fall camp is most of fall camp. They're in shorts and they wear pads and they're still in shorts. Yeah. They're not really doing it. So I think they need those Charlotte games. I do, but I. My biggest thing is I want variety at least, and I don't like seeing Georgia Tech over and over and over and
over. That's Wheel of Fortune. I was going to point somewhere that had the NFL on,
right.
And that was the point I was going to get at, is that we take for granted in college football that everybody, you expect people to be undefeated, and then you're in. And in no uncertain terms, you probably are, especially in Power 5. And it looks like we're going to have a few of those this year. But obviously, most of the teams that have made the playoff have had a loss or more, right? Most of them had a loss, right? Clemson last year was the first team, in year five, the first team ever to win undefeated, 15-0. And I celebrate that stuff. However, we could give Furman or the Chanticleers $2 million instead of $1.5 million to not play us, because now we have a playoff system where Clemson can, so say, for example, Clemson, Oklahoma, Alabama, and Notre Dame. Those are the top four. You take those four out. Now they can't play each other, but put them in a hat with the other top 25 teams and replace New Mexico State from your schedule next year. Replace Furman. I brought up the NFL because there's no undefeated teams in the NFL ever. It just doesn't work that way because of the level of competition. College football didn't have that. It has that now, right? Where if everybody had those big matchups and we weren't forced to look at people and say, well, UCF's undefeated. Yeah, but they played literally two fewer games and no ranked teams and zero Power 5 teams in that season. And they let a bunch of teams score 50 on them at home. That's the kind of stuff that the committee is committed to taking a really tough look at. And I would love to just replace some of the, look, make no mistake, Morgan, I'd love to see Tennessee just get relegated right the hell out of the SEC because of how bad they've been. And
yeah,
Rutgers, sure. Yeah, take Rutgers out, put
probably
UCF
be,
in.
I guess right now, you know, the
Vanderbilt?
Vanderbilt's not really doing that well.
How dare you didn't
I know.
Say
you're
Vanderbilt's
say
better
that.
Than Tennessee.
I know. I mean, Vanderbilt's not
worse
doing
than Tennessee.
Good either.
I don't
you know, Derek
know.
Mason is on the hot seat right now, according to a lot of people. Even though he started out strong,
but more to your point,
I like
to
the
start
idea of what
changing
you're saying,
some of the regular season scheduling. Rather, we can't just add games onto the end of the season.
No, I don't like that.
I also don't think that four games is what we have. We have four plus an asterisk, right?
Yeah.
Like, so the SEC title game determines who's not going into the playoff.
Definitely,
right?
Yes.
Stuff like that. Last year, Oklahoma won the Heisman and got into the playoff because of their first ever conference championship game, right? That's important stuff. It's also an eliminator for other teams.
We need to figure out the
regular season a little bit better.
I think everybody wants to monkey with the playoff schedule and adding more to that. I don't think that that's the right way to go.
Five.
I agree with you.
It's a stupid number. It's prime. It's power five. It's such a dumb number to have for a true playoff system. You can't.
Well, I think that the championship games work their way out, and right now the Pac-12 worked their way out. You know, so and then at one point didn't the Big Ten work their way out, you know, and the Pac-12. So it's
you say that Ohio State, were they better than Notre Dame last year? And again,
well, yeah, there would be a debate for that,
yeah,
for sure.
Good
which,
debate.
Which who's to say?
But that's the debate people use for eight, and I think we should just have better games.
And you're still
going to
have that, I think, in eight. That's why I do like the relegation part. Because that's why I do like the promotion part. Because I think if you did that for 10 years. Then before you know it, man, you've got your Power Five conferences are stacked.
I think it's brilliant. I've never heard anything like it, and it's genius. It's genius.
You're agreeing with me then?
Oh, absolutely.
Because at first I thought
I'm going to start using it for myself.
At first I thought you were against it.
No. Anything that gets Tennessee out of the SEC, I'm all in. Yeah.
Well, I'm just saying.
But like Rutgers, people consider Rutgers Power Five, and it's like, do you want to play Rutgers
really?
Or do you want to play UCF?
Yeah.
Like, because they're not Power Five.
I mean, same thing for Rutgers. Hey, why not throw in Cincinnati instead of Rutgers in there? Why,
I don't want to play Cincinnati.
I mean,
2 years ago, South Florida was just as competitive as Central Florida.
Same
Nobody
thing.
Talked
same thing
them.
Like a Boise
Memphis,
State.
Memphis, Houston.
Why not throw?
We already
want Boise State in the Pac-12. Let's just go ahead and get them in there.
Thank you very much.
Let's make them locked in feeder. So let's say ACC, the feeder is the American. You know, the SEC, the feeder. I don't even know who it would be, but the Midwest would the feeder would be to the Pac-12. So you'd know where your kind of group of five would feed into and promote and relegate from.
Yeah.
So and then maybe
it's
not
brilliant.
Maybe not do it every single year, but maybe say, hey, you know what? Over the past 3 years, you know what?
Say why not every single year?
Say you know what? Over the past 3 years, Georgia Tech, you haven't been doing it. You've been terrible. Or Louisville, you've been terrible the past 3 years. Louisville, we're going to move you back to the American. Weren't they in the American at one time, or they were in the Big East? No, that's right.
Yeah, the Big East.
So,
the Big East.
So we'll Louisville will move you down, right? We'll move you down to the American, and we'll bring up Cincinnati. You know, I keep saying Cincinnati, but there are a lot
that's
of
a good
other,
example. I'm fine with it.
A lot of other top, you know, group of five teams out there that you could pull from.
Memphis.
I
would love to see Memphis play. I don't care. Auburn. Play Georgia. Play Clemson.
Yeah.
Or Houston when they were at, you know, sort of, I wouldn't say peaking, but there's been more competition nationwide than we've ever. Look, okay, Syracuse. We take for granted that last year was the best team they've ever had in their history, right?
Right.
But people were sort of tilting their noses up at Clemson because they nearly lost to them at home. You shouldn't lose to Syracuse. Like, no, no, no. It's because you're not paying attention to how good Syracuse is. And yeah, they've never been there before. But again, they're already in a Power 5 conference. Mm-hmm. If they were playing in the American, it wouldn't surprise me at all. There's a soft spot in my heart, Morgan, for the American conference. Yeah, yeah, I can't get anybody to watch. But and I mean no disrespect, because this is going to sound disrespectful, and maybe it is, but I don't mean it that way. The American as a whole is stronger than the Coastal right now in terms of elite competitiveness, and none of them are supremely elite, but we've seen enough of it to say, hey, we have to start looking at this in a more constructive way, right, to change how we schedule teams. We can't just leave it and say, well, everybody else plays an FBS team, why can't we? Or we should, because that's a competitive advantage is for us. Why would we want to, as Clemson, we schedule two SEC teams every year. Mm-hmm. Why would we want to add Georgia on top of that? Well, guess what? They just did. They're going to play them home and away right. In, what is it, 4 years? Mm-hmm. When is that game
and
come
the,
up?
And
Clemson's scheduling is great, but we need something for everybody where we all have this game that we can prepare for. Mm-hmm. And the logistics are going to be a nightmare, right? Okay, if we say, okay, Alabama, you finished number two, and now you have to play number 23 Michigan State from last year. Where are you going to play? I don't know, but we'll figure it out. And that's the logistics that we can, that would benefit the sport enough to give more money to teams like Furman and Coastal to stay relevant, to stay alive, mm-hmm. right?
And I think eventually they do just what we're saying with that system. They really have done that, and they'll get locked in for 15 years or so, and then you might see a promotion.
Long.
So eventually you'll see, like, and I assume that eventually you'll see an Appalachian State go to a group of five. Well, if they're eventually going to get to a group of five, why don't we just make it kind of like the norm? Like, okay, Appalachian State's doing really good. Let's move them up to a group of five. Maybe really bad group of five team. Let's move them down, you know, and try that out. Or you know, like, I mean, they're already in a group of five. Sorry.
So I hear you.
What I'm saying is move them into a Power Five.
Right.
And then maybe a bad Power Five team, move them down. I'm looking at the list here. You got SMU, and recently SMU wasn't good, but they're starting to do better.
You mean when Chad Morris was there?
Yeah, Chad Morris. But by the way,
and
Chad
now he's
Morris
in Arkansas doing great things. Nope.
No. Yeah, and you know, like, that's the thing. Like, you're not guaranteed to be a great coach if just because you're a great coordinator. Just like Manny Diaz, I don't think he's a great coach.
Frankly, it seems I talked about this last week. It seems incredibly rare. I don't know how you decide who. There's been a lot of elite. Let's put it this way. Brent Venables,
yeah,
arguably the best defensive coordinator of the
country. But would he be the best coach?
Maybe he'd be a total zero as a coach.
Maybe.
I doubt it, because I've seen the way he leads young men. Mm-hmm. But yeah, maybe.
But there's a different
Jeremy
temperament
Pruitt was the best
need.
DC at Alabama under Nick Saban, and he's doing not great at
Tennessee. Jeremy Pruitt could beat Clemson. I mean, Jeremy Pruitt beat Clemson at Georgia, at Florida State, and at Alabama. So Jeremy Pruitt had the special sauce or whatever defensive scheme to stop Clemson teams for whatever reason. But he's terrible head coach at Tennessee, right? I think Brent Venables, I mean, I think he has a great temperament for a blitzing defense. I don't know if he has a great temperament for a head coach. We'd have to see and try and see.
Yeah, that's it.
Tony Elliott. You know, I think Tony Elliott is a pretty smart guy when it comes to offensive coordinator.
Yeah.
But he's not really a guy that really enjoys being in front of the camera. You know, you gotta be the president.
You gotta be the figurehead.
Obama, the you know, I don't want to say Trump, you know, and be controversial, but you gotta be that guy who's not embarrassed.
He is our president. I don't even know what to say about that.
He's not embarrassed about getting in front of the camera, in front of the and you know, kissing babies and signing signatures. You know,
frankly,
and
that's what he's best at.
Posters and stuff. And so
not Dabo. Whatever.
Dabo understands too. Dabo doesn't. You know, Dabo calls plays in certain situations. He feels the game. He's a time manager. He understands that, but he's not the coordinator by any means. Like you were talking about before, he wasn't a coordinator before. He was a wide receivers coach.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And then became a head coach, which everybody scoffed at. Oh, how dare you. But people saw him, and the players really promoted him the best, like CJ Spillers of the world.
Okay.
Said, hey, this guy can do it. You know, he was already their recruiting coordinator and getting them really good recruiting classes for as bad as they were playing at the time. Or as average as they were, right? He was getting good recruiting classes for an average team.
Incredible, yeah.
And he was that guy where you could just tell, hey, he can be the face of this team. And, you know, can Brent Venables do that? I don't know. Can Tony Elliott do that? I don't know. I mean, I think that...
Somebody would give him a shot.
I think, sure. Kind of like what we talked about earlier in the podcast, you've got to take that risk.
Yep.
And so I don't blame anybody for taking that risk. Chad Morris took the risk. It's not really working out for him right now. But I think... You know, Brent Venables has got to be locked in. I mean, his youngest son is playing it at Daniel, probably going to come in. His oldest son is playing right now for the Tigers. Brent Venables not going anywhere. Jeff Scott and Tony Elliott, the great thing about them is they grew up as, you know, in the system. His dad, Brad Scott was a coach, grew up in the system. They both played.
I love that.
Not a lot, but they played. And then Elliott, I think, played more than Scott. But now they've graduated and they became GAs and worked their way up, right? Yeah. So they're homegrown talent, and I don't think they have any need. I mean, to me, I mean, maybe they have an aspiration to be a head coach, and I say go for it.
But
I wouldn't blame them. Yeah, if they had to, they probably would have done it by now with the much successes they've had. You know, they're exactly where they like we said earlier. If you find a job that you love, you know, I mean, why leave? I mean, enjoy it. I mean, not everybody has that opportunity.
Because you're making $2 million instead of $4 million?
Yeah, and chasing money
maybe
is not a good thing.
Yeah, maybe that's not a big enough
reason. I chased
money
when I was early in my career. I went and worked in downtown Atlanta chasing money, and I was miserable. And I vowed never to do that again. I mean, you know, if you love what you do, I mean, eventually it's going to work out to where you're making money where you need to, you know, survive. You know?
I hope Trevor Lawrence loves doing things like completing long passes for explosive plays, and that's what he does this weekend at home against Florida State, the Seminoles.
I believe there's going to be a lot of opportunity, for sure.
Good. I'm with you. You got anything else you want to leave us with?
Well, I just want to let everybody know, if you've listened to this podcast, and you've enjoyed it.
The Gray Zone. We had to rename it.
I love it.
I don't love it.
Well, maybe we'll work it out, and I'll do a logo for you.
Okay, great. You have to put your name on it and stuff, which I'm still, in spite of doing Fat Greenville TV for 5 years now, it's still sort of foreign to me. It's like we talked about before we started recording. Like, it's important to do challenging things, and I believe that. I think the best leaders are teaching the best guys to do that stuff. I wish more people were teaching other people to do it. And if you're listening and you're one of them, the opportunity is now. It's knocking at your door. It's listening. It's now. In your ear, so do it.
Yes. And so I would say, if you're watching or listening to the show and you enjoyed it and you want to hear more from me, which I hope you do, you can check me out on Facebook, The Morgan Thomas Show, which, you know, we talk about original names. That is not very original. A lot of my family are like, really? The Morgan Thomas Show? Really?
I thought it was going to be a girl. And pretty blunt.
Yeah, I blame my mom for that too, you know, giving me that name. I actually have three first names, three last names, or three middle names, Joseph Morgan Thomas. So you can rearrange my name any way you want. But my dad was named Joseph, so we went with
Morgan. You were bound to be a country star.
You know, I mean, Morgan is actually more popular now for guys. Back in the day, it wasn't, and it was tough going in school. But now it's pretty normal. There is a country singer named Morgan, I believe.
I still have a crush on Morgan Fairchild and Morgan Thomas. Competition.
Thank you. But you can check me out, Facebook, The Morgan Thomas Show. YouTube, The Morgan Thomas Show.
I definitely recommend it.
Twitter, you know, at Clemson Morgan. Then you can check out the replays over on The Roar every Thursday night, 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. You'll get a radio replay edit of the show. But on Wednesday night is our live show, 8:30 to 9:30. Well, we go over like this show.
That's fine.
So 8:30 is to start live, Facebook, YouTube. We simulcast. And come check us out. We talk all things. Really, all things college football, but primarily with a focus on the team from God's country, the Clemson Tigers.
I thought this was going to be one of the shorter podcasts. This is literally the longest podcast I've ever done.
Yes!
So thank you, Morgan.
That was my goal.
True champion right here. Heart of a Tiger.
This is what happens when you get two hosts on a show. There's no timekeeper.
Exactly right. Nobody's listening. It's all crickets out there. It's just us. It's fine. I don't care. I did want to highlight.
We just keep setting each other up for more conversation.
Okay. Well, the live YouTube show on Wednesdays at what time?
8:30 p.m.
Okay. 8:30 on YouTube. Morgan Thomas. I definitely highly recommend that. If you're a Clemson fan and you're a bigger fan than most of your friends out there, that this is probably for you. You will enjoy it. I recommend getting on there and participating in it, because the questions, it's really interesting to see how they do everything. It's well produced. It's really well done, Morgan. I think you do a great job, especially after a bye week when people are more hungry for it, and even more especially before a rival. I still consider this a rivalry game against Florida State. That's where you want to go. Also, 4th and 16, obviously, with Ellis Tolbert. I think it's E. Tolbert Speaks on Twitter.
Yep.
If you search for 4th and 16, you'll find it. That's another great podcast. It's also on WCCP The Roar on Thursday nights. It's a great I don't know how I didn't know this, Morgan, but that y'all are back-to-back on mm-hmm. Thursday nights?
That's just fantastic.
Yeah. I would much rather listen to the two of y'all on a recorded podcast on WCCP than watch North Carolina State and, wait a second, who are they playing again this weekend? I should care. It's Syracuse, right? I
would rather listen to CBS Radio talking about teams you don't care about. Right?
Still, I care about all of them. I really do, but I'd still rather listen to y'all talk about Clemson in a game that hasn't even happened yet. So do that. Go to iongreenville.net. Do your Ion Greenville pick'ems. There's still plenty of time. We're going to air this Wednesday, but a lot of people look like missed their picks last week while we were all at Skunk Fest, and that's okay because we barely talked about last weekend, and I figure that's for everybody's benefit because it really looked like it sucked. I didn't watch a single snap of any game. Thank God, because this weekend is the exact opposite, and I can't wait. FET Greenville Magazine, F-E-T-E, it comes out, FETGreenville.com, every single Wednesday, be there. Everything you need to know about what's going on is going to be on FET Greenville TV. If it's not, it's in the Ion Greenville app. And thank you again to the Growler House in the Village of West Greenville. This is terrific. Did you enjoy your beer?
Yes, it's down. It's good. It's done.
He's smashed, folks. That's why he's not making any sense. We love it here. We love the ambiance. They treat us real nice here. It's really fun. And obviously a lot of college football love here. So thanks again, Morgan. Go Tigers. Roll Tide.
Yeah,
go Tigers. Dogs. F you all the time. Hail State, like I'm trying to get them all in there because I just want to see them all. Go Bearcats, baby. Beat UCF. I got to celebrate that one a little bit. My cats. All right, thanks, y'all. Peace. Not red, not blue, not white, not green, just gray. Just great.